Oh, it was candy painted.
Oh, yeah. Uh-huh.
All right. Where are we? Everything up? Everything plugged in? All right, it's time to tune in and wild out. It's Mornings with Matt and Bob, powered by Chuy. Man, what a night we had. What a day we had yesterday. Do you think the eclipse had anything to do with it?
I don't think so.
That was nuts. I'll tell you about it in just a second. I'll tell you about the 4 hours I spent in the parking garage yesterday watching YouTube videos. Good morning. It's Mornings with Matt and Bob, powered by Chuy. We're here to make your morning just a little bit better, a little bit brighter, a little bit drier, if that's even possible. I hope you didn't get hailed on, but we're going to hail down you. We're going to rain down on you today with some laughs, some controversies, some stories. Let's do the starting lineup so you know the players taking the field right now. On your behalf, the man straight ahead, the hardest working man in show business, a heavyweight champ in every aspect of his life, and man, there is a cavalcade.
You sure about that?
He is a shoe head, a food head. He's got a Thursday night YouTube. He's on Twitch. He's got a Twitch extravaganza called Nonversation. With Spence. Is Spence still on it?
Yeah, he still does.
Good. Ladies and gentlemen, he keeps the levels 5x5, takes your phone calls on the fly, puts up the podcasts. Ladies and gentlemen, please, hands together, both hands, for the incomparable Mr. Chuy Eldorado.
Thank you, Bob Father.
Now this next guy, the guy to my right, we got his back today, all day. I'm going to lift him up to higher ground, ladies and gentlemen. I won't say, we'll talk about it, I'm sure, but it's a big day, big night, ladies and gentlemen. Former star of episodic television, stand-up comedian extraordinaire, even ran his own shows for years and years and years, exposing Austin to brand new talent. That's right. He was like our own, what's the guy that does America's Got Talent? What's his name? The English guy.
Simon Cowell.
Yeah, he's our, like, our own, thank you. He's like our own Simon Cowell.
That's American Idol.
Ladies and gentlemen. Same thing. Ladies and gentlemen, what can I say about this guy? The greatest, Austin's greatest living storyteller. The marvelous. Mr. Matt Bearden is here.
Thank you so much.
I could have done better. I'm not talking very well today. I'm very sleep deprived this week. I don't know why.
I think we all got a case of that. He's sleep deprived, but that, I wouldn't worry. That's not going to slow him down one step. Mm-hmm. He says that to be humble, but there's no reason for him to be humble. He looks good. He sounds good.
Just keep on going.
He floats when he walks, ladies and gentlemen. Muhammad Ali would not want to take this guy on. That's all I've got to say. Damn. So he's got the coolest watches. He's got the coolest hats. He's got the coolest cars. He's got the coolest hi-fi equipment. He's got the coolest wife. He is... No other word to describe him. Cool. He's cool Bob, please.
Oh, thank you.
That's right.
Thank you very much.
He's a member of the Texas Radio Hall of Fame, and he has been running this show for 30-some-odd years. And I don't think he's going to stop anytime soon, so you better get used to it, ladies and gents. Long-time Austin resident, and he punches well above his weight. Here he is, the Bob Father himself, Mr. Bob Fonseca.
Oh, man. Thank you. How you guys? Good seeing you guys. I feel like this is... I'm glad to be here, actually.
I woke up in a war zone.
Every morning to be with my friends. It's kind of nice to work with people that you like. It's like an added bonus to work. We should do that as a topic sometime.
Like each other?
Well, no, it's just like I'm sure many people go to work every day and dread the people they have to hang out with.
Yeah.
You know?
No, there's all kinds of memes, like when you have to leave a job or the guy, you know, because it's always odd pairings. It's always like some young 19-year-old and then some 70-year-old, you know, guy that you grow attached to at your job. And I don't know. I think it happens at all jobs. Mm-hmm. I think because you have a common enemy.
Yeah. Right.
Which is, you know, the boss and management.
Right.
That brings you together.
And work, yeah, like always. And that's why servers all have make love to each other.
Is that true?
Yeah.
I got to go back. I need to get a part-time job.
I need to.
What's the minimum number of hours I have to do in the service industry a week to get that benefit?
20.
That's it?
Yeah. The three that I worked at, one, I got no play at all. Like, at all. But one of them, it was like, you thought I was Mario Lopez or something.
Mm-hmm. Or they did.
Maybe they thought racist.
And what do they do? Write it down on a little check or something on a piece of paper? Like, let's hook up? What? Like, how does that?
No,
how does
it overtly flirting.
How does it organically happen? Like,
that's when I discovered women will
little bumps
approach
in the door.
You or will talk to you.
Mm. Yeah.
You just got to be attractive enough, I guess.
Yeah.
Jim's taking a long time.
Problem is, if I get in that industry, what was that?
So this gym's taking a long time. I used to be able to bounce back in like 6 weeks, or like 2 months,
yeah.
And now it's been 3 months, and it's barely like things barely move an inch.
I'm coming off a 36 hour fast, I guess. 36, 40 hour.
I was thinking about getting testosterone treatments. Can y'all get test treatments?
No, you remember what happened when I did that? You got to be careful.
Well, my body needs.
You got to know what you're go to a good place and know what you're doing because it's not a very exacting science.
Well, like some steroids too.
Hey, look me in the eye real quick. Bob sometimes is sensitive when he believes he's taking medication.
You don't want that.
I know. That's for people that don't like lift weights. But if you use that and combine with lifting weights, it goes to the right places.
Okay. All right.
I think it's common practice now. Like some.
I don't think you need.
I don't think I need it.
I think
either,
you have more than enough testosterone. I think you got enough testosterone for the entire room. In fact, you should need to break off a piece. You know what I'm saying?
I don't think so.
I think so. I don't know a dude that has more testosterone than you. And I haven't even done your labs or anything, but I can just tell.
No, I don't want to fight.
You exude it.
And F as much anymore, you know?
Well, do you think that has to do with the...
Yeah, it could be.
The ganj?
It could be.
That's what I see.
What do you mean it could be?
They're bringing the testosterone down.
Yeah.
Those are all things we know through science about the ganj.
And by ganj, I mean the Dutchies.
Well, it's what just, am I going to supplement
it's with? Just dopamine in general. If you're feeding that, then you're going to reduce the eye of the tiger. By the way, I did last night dream that I had a bunch of different kinds of tigers and lions in an office building, and I had to try to keep them all separated, but in different offices.
Oh, boy.
But I also had some gazelles.
It was
gazelles.
Like Noah's Ark, but it was an office.
I had some gazelles as well, and I had to figure out.
This is cool. This is biblical.
Yeah, it was really bizarre. I was trying to keep them from eating each other and killing me.
Where do you keep the monkeys? And do you separate the breeds of monkeys?
There were no monkeys.
Oh, there were no
monkeys? Just a couple of dogs is all. But it turned out that the dogs were getting along with the big cats just fine.
Interesting. Yeah.
Very interesting, if you ask me.
Anybody else wake up to a war zone this morning?
I felt like all last night was a war zone. I spent several hours in a parking garage at the Hill Country Galleria because the hail started. I'll show you pictures of hail in our area. It was about, not quite golf ball size, but what would you call that size?
Testicle size?
Inside, yeah.
That is, that.
I'm trying to think. Like, oh,
probably
okay,
not.
I got it. Like, okay. Exactly, Chick-fil-A nugget size.
Oh, okay. Like the boot or the round?
No, that's the McDonald's.
Chick-fil-A.
Chick-fil-A.
Yeah, the tiny, like that, you know.
Nah, they vary. They make me mad, too.
Like a little bigger than a little bigger than a sugar cube, but a little smaller than a Chick-fil-A nugget. That was raining down in our area yesterday, and I found myself away from home. Dylan called me. He says, man, you got to get to a garage because it's hailing here big time. And we only have, we only have garage space for two cars. So Jennifer was downtown at work, so she was protected. And so.
Oh, the elevator one was
so I just had to go into a covered parking garage and wait out these storms because I didn't know. And then the sun came out for an hour, and I go, oh, okay. So I go visit my dad, and then all of a sudden, all hell starts breaking loose an hour later.
All hail starts breaking loose
a second time.
Yeah.
And so I'm back in a parking garage for another 2 hours watching...
It's
Scooby-Doo. Thank God I've got YouTube in the, you know. Mm-hmm. That's the great thing about the Tesla is that you've got You got Tesla. You got Netflix.
I didn't even leave last night. I just accepted that there was nothing to do. So, you know, because we got hailed on pretty significantly. But when I left this morning, I mean, the streets are just filled with, there's a couple of down trees on my, you've been on my street. It's only 10 houses long. There's two down trees, one through a poor dude's truck. There's just crap everywhere in the streets from where the hail took out, you know, all the branches and stuff.
I didn't get home till after dark, wondering, so I don't even know.
Idea what my roof or my siding or my cars are like. And I can't see any of it because we have no electricity.
What size did you guys... Oh, you're out of electricity?
Yeah. Something arced last night. I heard it. It woke me up around 1 a.m. I heard...
And then boom.
And then everything went out. And then I heard them try to... You know, the city automatically tries to switch it back on. And I heard again...
And then when the hail was done for the second time, I counted two rounds of hail yesterday, starting at around 3 o'clock or whatever. Then the winds were crazy for like 4 hours.
Yeah, I think it's how we lost the trees.
It's like, what the... And this is a day after a solar eclipse.
Now,
don't tell
Bob,
me.
Why are you bringing the eclipse
don't
into this?
Don't be
one of those people. Bob, you're smarter than this. You went to college. You're smarter than this. This has nothing to do with an eclipse. Don't say all of a sudden, don't get into this with these people.
Well, no, maybe it has to do with some kind of weird gravitational pull.
Did every region that had the eclipse have hail?
I don't know.
Would that be a variable to check?
Yeah.
If we want to claim the hail has something to do with the eclipse.
Do we wonder why we had an eclipse in October? Why didn't we have hail the next day?
Yeah, I don't know.
Well, I do know. It's because they're not associated with each other.
I think they are.
Okay.
And I have no science to back it up other than it felt like it was all connected because it was so close. Right? But anyway.
I forgot.
Now that means my doorbell's going to ring all day long with dudes from Houston and Louisiana wanting to fix my roof. And I'm not going to fix it unless I see something dripping through.
Well, that you're not going to see from a hail damage, you're not going to see something dripping through necessarily.
The same way about my butt.
And with that, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you. We brought it full. Once we get to the butt humor.
That's the end. That's the end.
That means time to play a song.
Yeah, you can't. If once you get to the drippy butt.
That's where it stops.
Yeah.
The buck stops here.
The buck stops here.
I got no electric. I got no coffee at the house. I got to go figure that out.
Oh, don't drink this one.
Hang on. Hey, we got to finish yesterday's Click, Click, Boom. Coming up, we're going to find it. Top three music documentaries of all time.
Ooh.
What do you think, Bob? Pretty good start. Pretty good start for the day. It's been a good song choice, right?
I like this whole album.
I think it's better than
Synchronicity.
Better than playing White Snakes. Let's get into the clickbait. We go through the clickbait, so you don't have to. I'm glad we haven't recorded that in a little thing where it would just play.
Yeah.
And go, click, click, boom. We go through the clickbait, so you don't have to. And then I wouldn't have to say it every morning.
Get L.A. to...
I think he came up with that.
L.A.'s
after.
Got a good voice.
Well, I understand that, but I mean...
I'll get his email.
As a good producer, couldn't you just record one of those?
I can just say it.
Say it right now. Let me hear.
Click.
I see you blow it. Take two.
All right.
We did the clickbait.
No. Take three.
Click boom. Click. Hold on. Let me do it.
Click it or tick it.
I got to hear the song, you know, when I'm singing. That's click, click, boom. We do the clickbait. So you don't have to.
I think I could do a better announcement.
Yeah, we go. Let me hear you. Bob, it's your audition time. You want the very beginning of it?
Yeah. We go through the clickbait.
It's
so
not,
you
not even
don't have to.
We don't. I have never said we go through
What do you say? Just tell me what this. Give me the script.
I forgot what I say.
We go through the clickbait so you don't have
what
to.
What did I say?
It should be we do the clickbait so you don't have
all
to.
Right.
Is that what
you
said?
We do.
It sounds better.
All right.
Hold on.
We do the clickbait so you don't have to.
I don't like it. Now that I hear it out loud, I don't like it. I heard it out of my own mouth. It's been there for a couple of years. I don't like the way it sounds.
We click through the bait so you don't have to.
We cut bait so you can click more.
We sell golf clubs.
No, we buy golf clubs. We buy golf clubs.
We do the clicking so you can relax.
Yeah.
Let's get into it. Number three. Yesterday, we went over, you know, the best documentaries, best rock documentaries, right, of all time?
Yep.
Just a reminder, Kurt Cobain's montage of Heck was on the list. Amy, the documentary about Amy Winehouse, is on the list. Stop Making Sense. But the Talking Heads was on the list.
I don't know why you don't like that one.
The Talking Heads, they don't connect with me. That's why I don't like it.
I think they're kind of funky and kind of good.
And at number four, The Decline of Western Civilization. About the entire collection. Yeah, four-disc set. About, you know, the entire, let's call it the L.A. music scene in the 80s.
Right.
Early 80s. Late 70s, early 80s. So now, we've said that I bet we're going to start recognizing some names. And Bob, do you want to take a guess at what might be in the top three?
Oh, oof. Of documentaries, I'm going to say The Beatles Get Back.
Okay, that's one we could put down. Right,
this new Little Richard documentary on HBO was fire.
Oh, I haven't seen that.
Yeah, watch it. It's good.
He's still alive, isn't he? Or did he die? No, he's still alive. I think he's still around.
I guess I didn't finish the documentary. No, I think he's dead.
No, I don't think. Did he? Is he?
Well, I'm going to give you a couple of hints on number three, Bob.
All right.
Okay. 1978.
Uh-huh. What was I doing in 78? Okay.
It's even been entered into the Criterion Collection. It's called A True Celebration of the End of an Era.
Oh, Last Waltz.
In music history. You nailed it. I didn't even have to get to the director, Martin Scorsese, which would have gotten it immediately.
The band's Last Waltz. I remember seeing it. I went to Thundercloud Subs on Riverside. Got a sub with my buddy Tom.
What kind of sub?
We went to the Village Cinema, and we saw...
Wait, you snuck a... sandwich into a theater?
No, we went. We had lunch. I remember that day,
okay,
man. I remember that day.
I mean, it's one thing to sneak a candy bar in your pocket, but who sneaks an entire
sub? No, we ate at the Thundercloud. There was a Thundercloud on Riverside Drive.
Okay.
And we had...
Right?
Yeah, I had a roast beef sub, I think, or something
like
that.
Wow, this is some detail.
I remember that day because that movie was so great and we had such anticipation for it. And we got into Tom's Volkswagen Bug.
Oh. Also the first time you did an armrest handy, right? That's why the memories are so crisp.
No.
Slug Bug.
It was a dude I met at a Springsteen concert. No, we went to UT together. And we went saw The Last Waltz at the Village Cinema 4 or whatever. It was a four... Is it still four theaters or is it six now? The Village... It's owned by Alamo Drafthouse now, but then it was just the Village on Anderson.
I don't know. I think it's four. Six. I think it's six.
Anyway, and we saw The Last Waltz, and it was really good. In stereo.
Was that about?
That was a big deal in 78 to see a movie in stereo. Isn't that hard to believe? Sound was so crappy in movies until...
And it's about a band called The Waltz?
Oh, my God, dude. Please, don't break the internet. Don't break...
You're gonna hurt Bob's feelings right now, okay?
You've never seen
the band.
Yeah.
Oh, the
band.
It
was their final concert.
And they never did another one?
On Thanksgiving.
They weren't one of these bands that comes out and says, we're doing a final tour, and then does eight more years of tours.
No, Robbie was serious, man. Robbie Robertson.
They said,
was serious.
We did our work. This is people used to be artists in the 70s, and they said, we did our work. Music is changing. The times they are changing. And it's time for us to be done. We've done our work here. And then they all went and did their own separate projects.
What was your favorite part of The Last Waltz?
Never seen it.
Mine is Van Morrison doing Caravan. Van Morrison steals the show.
Does he?
Steals the show.
My thing is that I remember once I finally learned about it, I really wanted to see it somewhere nice. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Not on my little 13-inch television.
How did they get Scorsese? Or was Scorsese not Scorsese yet?
No, Scorsese was Scorsese.
He had just done Taxi. I think this is the movie he did after Taxi Driver.
No. Hadn't he just done that with Terry Garr? Hadn't he just done that musical?
Let's see. This is 78.
A musical? New York, New York.
Oh, that's for Francis Ford Coppola.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's
well,
2 years.
But he did a musical. He did one with Liza Minnelli called New York.
Yeah, no. Remember, Francis Ford Coppola, for some reason, decided to do that musical called, like...
Yeah, I know. Finian's Rainbow or something?
Something like that, and it did not do well.
No. But, no, Scorsese was big.
Yeah, he'd it was already 2 years after
He'd
Taxi
already done
Driver.
Taxi Driver in 76.
And Mean Streets.
Mean Streets was before. That was, like, 74.
If somebody came to you and said, hey, do you want to put your name on something, on a huge band, And it's really going to take you like a month's worth of work total, as opposed to 3 years. And you'll get paid when you take that?
Yeah, I'd take that. Scorsese did The Color of Money.
Yeah. With Newman. Yeah. Yeah, he did.
Huh.
And Cruz, right?
Yeah.
Noted by Rolling Stone as being nostalgic with rich music, The Last Waltz is a true celebration of the end of an era of music history. The film beautifully captures the camaraderie between the musicians on stage as well as the raw talent that made the band such a beloved group.
Here's one of the
Last Waltz is a timeless tribute to the magic of live performances and the power of rock and roll.
Here was a challenging thing for Scorsese is that back then they were shooting on, obviously, film. And there's only so much film you can put in a 35mm camera.
You got to keep reloading during the concert.
And so there's a chance that you're going to miss something because of your always... I think you can get like 10 minutes in a Panavision. I don't know if they were shooting Aries or Panavision, but there's only so many minutes that you have before you have to take the camera apart.
It's like one movie scene.
Reload it with another magazine and keep shooting. And so there were times where I felt when I watch it, they had to insert some shots because they just didn't have the coverage. I don't know how many cameras Marty was shooting, but I call him Marty because we're that close. But it's a great film, man. I think you would like it. I think you would like it, Chuy. It's no funk or soul in there.
I might put it on the background while I'm vacuuming.
Neil Young's in there, Joni Mitchell, Dr. John.
Huh.
Van Morrison.
Who's that?
Eric Clapton.
Uh-huh.
It's all good stuff. You ever check out Bruce Robeson's The Next Waltz?
No, I heard about it, though.
You know, he did it, I think, just originally as one project, and he's continued on now. He's getting close to a decade. It's really fun. He also just picks out, you know, it has that same kind of feel of like, hey, we're friends, then we're songwriters here in the city. We take care of each other, and we play together, and a lot of it is just like on porches and stuff.
Well, there's somebody that does the complete Last Waltz here. They do the complete, it's a bunch of music. I don't know if Gowdy's involved or somebody. Somebody we know is involved, and they do it around Thanksgiving, I think.
Oh, really?
Where they do the entire, they do like every song from the movie.
That's cool.
I guess, if you can pull it off. It seems like, anyway.
Sounds good. Sounds good.
All right, now we're at number two.
What
could be better than the Last Wall? I mean, we got to be getting close to Woodstock territory.
We float a little bit.
We already did. The next documentary involves an artist who has really stirred up the S in the last week. I can't get on the Instagrams or the Twitters or whatever these days without somebody saying something horrendous about this artist. They're very upset. They feel that she has overstepped her bounds and gone beyond the gates that they are keeping.
Hmm.
Her name is Beyonce, and the documentary is Homecoming, a film by Beyonce.
Never saw it. That's number two?
Yeah, that's number two. Beyonce's iconic performance at Coachella in 2018. And this, she was kind of, it was a big deal because nobody had done this at the time. She came out and then just told people, oh, I happen to be filming this. People didn't necessarily even know. And really got into, and then I think these are the words that make people so upset right now, which I am, it's still beyond my brain how it upsets people, but she was... The themes are representation and inclusivity. And
ew,
you know how people see things like, what is it, DEI that's got people so scared these days? DEI was the new name for what was the other thing that they were teaching at colleges that was scaring people so much?
Critical race theory?
That's it. The CRT.
Critical thinking, yeah.
And then a lot of places said, look, critical race theory is only taught in like basically one upper division class. It's not even a thing that, so we'd chill out. And then they started using the name DEI. That's where they, you know, they just fired 60 staff at UT because the legislature enacted a new law saying it's illegal to have DEI departments at your school. So
I love The Handmaid's Tale.
Well, UT then changed the names and moved some people around, and then the legislature said, no, you're still doing it wrong. And so they forced them to fire you know, that's the job of the government, is to reduce job availability.
And definitely interfere in the classroom.
So, well, this isn't even classroom
just
stuff.
Have
it's
prayer
so
classes.
Silly. So,
prayer classes is all you need.
Well, you know, she has put out an album that I think you could argue is not country at all, but has some incredible country tracks on it. One in particular is a really good country song. It's made people very upset. The two-hour film was directed, written, and executive produced by Beyoncé herself. Landmark concert. Fans get to experience the meticulous planning, the dedication that goes into creating an event. And that's pretty cool, whether you're a Beyoncé fan or not, is to see the year out, them starting, mm-hmm. how they're going to do a single, that it's not just like, hey, let's just go out there and wing
yeah,
it.
Yeah, right. I don't know how I feel about that idea, though.
What?
Well, I guess she's not rock, but I'd like to think that rock is somewhat spontaneous. I know it's not, because I've worked in the arena business and I've worked.
Well, these are the music.
I've worked in radio, so I know there's no spontaneity whatsoever. But I want it at least to appear that way. I want it to appear that the artist is.
Well, then you're gonna you're gonna love the number one. You're gonna love the number one.
Yeah, Woodstock.
Because they,
it's got to be Woodstock.
No, the number one has even more spontaneity. In fact, it has something that most people were not expecting whatsoever in a documentary, especially about music.
Let It Be?
No.
How did Woodstock and Let It Be not make the list of?
It's directed by it's two brothers that I think might be two of your favorite documentarians, because they created a whole school of documentary thought.
Don't Look Twice? You're talking about the Bob Dylan documentary?
I'm not.
Who are the brothers?
David and Albert Maysles.
Yeah. Oh, Rolling Stones then.
And it's Gimme Shelter.
Yeah.
And when you start talking about spontaneity, nobody planned for them to capture a murder on film.
No. Mick Jagger.
Sorry for the spoiler alert, but there's a murder in the middle of the documentary.
Yeah, that's hardcore. When you see that documentary, and you see, you think the Rolling Stones at the height of their powers, right? At a speedway, on a stage that is literally, 2 feet off, 3 feet off the ground?
It's the size. It's also the size of the studio.
Surrounded by people, yeah. It's like, what were they thinking?
I don't know. Well, and you just said rock and roll is all about spontaneity and looseness. I think it would be interesting to watch Beyoncé's highly scripted performance with security and everything, because what she did is a direct result of what happened 50 years before when someone said, hey, let's go do a giant concert in California with no thought whatsoever.
Yeah. No, it's insane. When I saw the stage and I saw the people, literally you could just reach up and touch the stuff. And I think many people tried.
Hey, it's described as showcasing the darker side of the 1960s counterculture movement. And that is kind of important, because when I grew up as a kid, I thought the 60s was all hippies that were in love and bringing love and guidance mm-hmm. and care. I didn't realize that those hippies were all going to grow up to be baby boomers. And sorry, boomers, but some of your friends are kind of assholes. I don't know if you've noticed. Raw and candid footage, Gimme Shelter offers a chilling glimpse into the downfall of the peace and love era.
It's dark.
Making it a must-watch. Boy, when they do that thing where they're in the edit room and you're watching them edit the documentary, but they click back one step and you hear they're like, no, right there. Right there.
That's where the dude gets.
You ever seen this one, Chuy?
Uh-uh.
Do you know what happened at Altamont? Do you know the story?
Mm-mm.
Do you know who they hired for security?
Hell's Angels.
Yeah.
Yeah.
For what? You know how much?
$50.
No, like some cases of beer?
Yeah,
it was pretty much. But just the lack of security, the lack of protection. I don't even know.
A lot of people say it was
why the Stones would even take the stage. What little stage there? It was like a plywood. It's like a stage.
They were on a ping pong table. They were on a ping pong table.
You would build in your backyard.
They put three ping pong tables together and started to do a concert. The thing was, is that a lot of people look back at this as the instance when it all started falling apart. The peace and love movement started falling apart and becoming unsustainable. And then it just really started. It started the downward slide into the very unhappy beginning of the 1970s. the disillusionment, really, but it also probably hastened the end of the Vietnam War because the country really came unglued at that point.
Yeah. No, that's a good one. But they left a lot of good documentaries off the
table. They did.
I mean, it's got to be...
Yeah, that's kind of shocking.
It's a classic.
Except it's so much of it is performance, too, right? You'd think it would have been different.
Yeah, but you have the storm, and you have all the controversy of the gates coming down. It becomes a free concert. There's documentary aspects to it, but a lot of great. It's a super long movie, and there's a lot they left on the table. And did you know Scorsese was an editor on that?
I didn't.
That's one of the things that he cut his teeth on as a filmmaker. He was an editor on Woodstock.
What else could be was left off? You talked about the Beatles.
Well, because of the label. Let It Be, where you see the Beatles disintegrating before your very eyes. You see Ringo leaving the band. You see, in another moment, George Harrison leaving the band. You see all the arguments that they were having, you know, in that, trying to make this movie and trying to make this record, which turned out to be Let It Be, which came out weirdly after Abbey Road, which was recorded after Let It Be, but it's weird watching the Beatles kind of argue. And
another good one, and Pete, not everybody out there may be a fan, so you may not want to watch it because you may not dig the music, but if you want to watch a band kind of come apart at the seams too.
Oh, Wilco?
No, but in that same vein, it's called Quiet, Loud, Quiet. It's about the Pixies.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
And if you want to see egos and passive aggressive, it's hard to watch because it's shot and you're but you know what's boiling up underneath the whole time, and you're like, ugh, this is
same,
too
sounds exactly like I'm trying to break your heart
break your
by
heart.
Wilco, where you see division within a band and you see power struggles and creative arguments and things like that. Ultimately somebody leaves, but I won't say who. I love that stuff. I'm surprised we've never been documented.
Well, we have. We have 30 years of podcasts, and we even have some of all that same stuff, unfortunately.
If Michael Jackson's This Is It counts.
I did see that. It's pretty good.
It's fire, bro. The way he's still moving and doing things.
You really see with the dedication he put into it, too.
Bob, will you tell the fine folks out there...
All right, it's Mornings with Matt and Bob, powered by Chuy. I'm on the wires right now, pulling down rock and roll news stories, and I'll convert to my other persona as rock's last great reporter. I got all the headlines for you coming right up after John Fogerty tells you this. Hey, Billy Joel's coming to your TV, maybe.
I report the news,
maybe.
That's what I do.
It's Bob Fonseca's rock and roll news.
Oh, yeah, man. Oh, yeah, it's rock and roll news time. I'm rock's last great reporter, Bob Fonseca. Yes. I got some banging headlines for you today, man, so you don't look like a doofus when you go to work today. We had hail damage last night. I'm about ready to give you some rock damage today. The rock is going to rain down on you.
No, not hail on us.
I got all, and kids, don't worry, I got big headlines for you, too, if you're on your way to the dropout zone right now. Stick around, okay, because Uncle Bob has got some rock stories for you as well. Well, kind of rock anyway. Billy Joel! By the way, did I tell everybody that I don't make the rock news? I just report it, right?
You mentioned it.
Don't kill the messenger. If I have a story you don't like or a take that you don't like, well, just live with it, all right? I've been doing this a lot longer than you. All right, this is the weirdest story I've ever read. I don't even know why I'm leading with it, to tell you the truth. But Billy Joel, we all love Billy Joel. He's got so many hits. Hey, Matt, what was the album he recorded early on that they recorded at the wrong speed and he sounded like a chipmunk? Cold Harbor, Cold something Harbor?
I don't know this one.
Look it up.
I don't know this one, my friend.
They finally straightened it out back in the 90s.
Well, I'm glad they did.
Cold Spring Harbor, I think, was the album, and it was recorded at the wrong speed. And they said, well, screw it. Well, that's the way we're going to release it. And Billy Joel sounded like a chipmunk on that record. They recorded it too slow, and then when they mastered it, it came out too fast. That's what happens when you... That's how you record the chipmunks.
Album.
You record them at a real slow speed, right? Regular people singing. And then when you play it back at normal speed, then it's like, you know, little inside baseball from your Uncle Bob here. Anyway, Billy Joel.
Hi, Billy Joel.
Hey, Billy.
Is going to have his 100th live show at Madison Square Garden this Sunday, April 14th. Yeah. The special, there's a TV special that was shot at his record-breaking 100th performance at Madison Square Garden, the square circle, they call it, because it's not actually square. Did you know that?
It's a circle.
Yeah. It looks a little like the Irwin Center in a way, because it's
I always thought that's what they called the boxing ring, so.
Madison Square Garden was a garden in the old days, in the 1800s or whatever, in New York City, that was adjacent to the area where that was built. So the building is not real. They named the building after a kind of a park that no longer exists in New York City.
Oh, it also refers to a boxing ring and a wrestling ring.
It does?
Yeah.
Look at this. Ever hear Frank Sinatra play Madison Square Garden? You ever hear those concerts?
No, I bet that's fine.
Oh, man. You know it.
Hey, does it make me a bad person if I don't really get Frank Sinatra?
You got to be Italian.
Yeah, you got to be a little goomba, you know.
Because I hear it, and I'm like, yeah, that's fine. I don't understand the level of popularity he achieved when I listen to his music.
I think he was that. Yeah, he was that. This is my take. We needed something in between Elvis and Glenn Miller.
Okay.
You know what I mean? Yeah. He was kind of the transition to rock and
roll.
No, those squeaky clean guys. Frank was the dude that would get into fistfights in bars and was
also
connected
confusing
to the mob.
He's in the mob, where the mob certainly liked him, and he seems to me to be a little bit of a softy. I don't understand that.
Presidents love. No, he could throw hands.
When you look at him.
He became a movie star, then he created the Rat Pack with Dino and no, I know what you mean.
He looks a little like you give him one margarita, he's going to open his legs.
Looks like a Nancy boy.
Yeah. Looks like me. That's what I'm trying to say. Looks like me. Looks like a Nancy boy.
Soft hands.
You got to read a book about him.
I'm not going to read. That's stupid.
Yeah.
The most amazing.
Can they make a YouTube video?
There was one story that I read that just kind of put the whole thing in perspective.
Okay. Well, if they make that into a cartoon, then I'll know.
It was in Vegas or L.A. or something like that, and Peter Lawford, one of the Rat Pack, the English Rat Packer. As looking out his hotel window and down in the, he sees Sammy Davis Jr. running across the courtyard of the hotel or whatever at a fury pace, and he yells down through the open window, "What's going on?" And Sammy Davis goes, "Frank's up." I mean, that says it all. I mean, that's Frank's up.
Yeah.
What was that, like on stage?
No, he's up. He's awake.
Oh, we all got to get.
Let's go.
Let's go.
Get moving. But I think that Frank Sinatra was the gateway between whatever we were doing in the 40s and World War II, Glenn Miller Orchestra, whatever. I don't know what rock was back then, but he was kind of a rock star, but very highly controversial. I think there's a lot. Well, I guess there's a lot we know. Anyway, this Billy Joel concert is going to be on a network called Global and Stack TV. So I guess none of us are watching it.
Yeah, it sounds like none of us are watching it.
I have no idea. Why would they do that?
Because Global wants to be known, and so they went to him and said, "Hey, if we pay you $1 million, will you do a concert?" And he was like, "Yeah, sure, I'll do one concert for $1 million. I don't care if nobody sees it. People see me every single week at Madison Square Garden."
Sting and Jerry Seinfeld make surprise appearances on the show. So I guess they were probably backstage. Aerosmith! Man, what's going on with Aerosmith? Is it time for them to maybe hang it up?
Woo!
I don't know.
Mm.
They're rescheduling dates back and forth. I'm not sure if the dates are on or off. Let's look at the story. Aerosmith is sharing the rescheduled dates for the band's Peace Out Farewell Tour. I feel like they've been doing this.
Well, it's been about 4 years.
Yeah, they've been canceling dates for 3 or 4 years.
Well, there's been some illnesses.
Now.
There's been some sicknesses. There was the whole COVID thing.
All right, as it stands right now, the trek will kick off on September 20th.
And will be canceled by September 22nd.
In Pittsburgh.
Delayed again.
And will conclude in February 26th, 2025 in Buffalo, New York. And
Well, that's not a lot of dates.
It's not, but you know...
But for a farewell show, you would think, you know, you'd think maybe they're going to do a year, but it sounds like they're like, hey...
They did some of the tour until Steven Tyler suffered vocal cord damage.
Here's what I would say.
Back in September 2023.
If you want to see... If you want to see them...
Yeah.
Aerosmith?
Mm-hmm.
This is probably your last chance ever to see
what?
Them.
What? Come on.
The big question is, can he survive the 41 remaining shows with his voice? Because he does have vocal cord damage, and I think he should take a page out of Ozzy Osbourne's playbook and have a singer behind the curtain helping out. You know what I mean? You know what I mean? You know what I mean?
No, I don't.
I noticed at Bruce's show, even though his voice is still pretty good to very good, I would say Bruce's. Voice is VG plus, but he did have his choir, his backup singers, you know, cover a lot of ground.
Plus, he's singing to a track. So,
hey, choir.
No, he doesn't. He doesn't.
Look how upset he gets whenever you say that. Look at how that his. Did you see the hair stand up on the back of his back?
He doesn't do that.
Like a dog sees another dog.
All right, Ozzy Osbourne may be gone for the stage, but that doesn't mean he's gone from the charts, but not from your hearts. Ozzy Osbourne is going to co-host a new web show. What is a web show? Is a web show a new name for a podcast? Why am I sounding like Jiminy Glick right now?
I don't know. I would say that what Chuy presents every week is a web show. I would say what you do is a web show.
Ah, so it's kind of recorded, maybe. Well, they're all recorded. Anyway, Ozzy Osbourne and Billy Idol guitarist Billy Morrison will co-host a new internet show called The Madhouse Chronicles starting this month. Morrison announced the show on Tuesday's episode of the Osbournes podcast. Our new show, The Madhouse Chronicles, is dropping this April. Join us as we sit back in the Osbourne Madhouse, reacting to the wildest internet clip. Oh, they're doing
Tosh.0.
They're doing Tosh.0.
They're
doing ridiculousness.
Money? Do you need more money, and do we need more Osbourne opinion?
They're going to be diving into topics like aliens, drugs, conspiracies, and rock and roll. All right. I don't hate it, but it's been done. But maybe Ozzy will bring something new to the game.
That has to do with music?
I was going to say he'll have something new that brings to the game when he has an on-air stroke, but I did that first, so...
Anyway, I don't know where you get that. Wherever,
no good?
I guess you get that wherever web shows are found.
That'd be the web.
Okay? Look for that. But I'm down with anything Ozzy wants to do. Sometimes it's just hard to find that stuff, you know? You know what I'm saying?
I think.
No. All right, now I'm excited about this, and Matt and I are going to go round and round about the significance of this band.
Oh,
this
boy.
Band, they were our Beatles.
Really? Okay? The Monkees?
And they made everyone on the planet want to move to California in the 60s.
Red Hot Chili Peppers?
For the Hot Rods.
He's going to talk about the Beach Boys, which is not a good band.
Oh,
they
are
a great band. And they're still out. The Beach Boys documentary is starting to get promoted by Disney Plus. Now, I find this interesting. I find that Disney Plus is getting involved in... listen, Disney has become more PG/R-rated than their name would indicate.
Because of Marvel. You have to lean into it.
You know, they're leaning into it. I mean, here's a band, the Beach Boys, on the outside look like all-American boys, but you got... You know, maybe a couple drug addicts in there. You got one of the members associated with the Manson family, and you got, you know, controversies and things like that.
I'll only watch if...
Were they the original Milli Vanilli? When you think about it, they were...
They didn't sing their own songs?
Well, they sang their own songs. They didn't really play their own songs that much.
Yeah.
They were capable, but...
They usually were at the beach chasing girls.
While Brian was in the studio
doing all the work.
With the Wrecking Crew.
I'll watch it if John Stamos is on the cover.
And then he would say,
"Hey,
guys."
That's the other thing where they fell apart was that instead of just giving up like most bands do, they decided, let's put together and then... Well, anyway, all this and more will be explained. I don't know how much they're going to sugarcoat it because Brian Wilson, you know, this has got... He started doing all those concerts on PBS and you had to watch your... everybody had to watch their dads dancing in the aisles.
I don't know how deep this document... I mean, I think it's going to be very good. I think we'll learn some stuff and we'll see some unreleased footage we've never seen before. But I think that this... whenever a documentary or film has the approval... yeah. for the oversight of family or the band themselves, you're not going to get the whole story more than likely. You know what I'm saying? Unless they're really, really...
You're saying that the band that was so protective of their image that they wouldn't allow anybody to sing the songs that they wanted to sing might also be protective of their image when they're making a documentary?
Good question, Matt. Brian Wilson, Mike Love, Al Jardine, David Marks, and Bruce Johnson, the original Beach Boys, will be featured in the film along with Carl Wilson and Dennis Wilson, both gone now, Brian's brothers. Carl died of natural causes. Dennis Wilson drowned, ironically.
Well, yeah, except guess who else was at his house that night?
Who?
Bill and Hillary Clinton.
Yep.
Lindsay Buckingham, Janelle Monáe, Don Was make appearances. There'll be many more stars, of course. The official trailer's out. This will air on Disney Plus on May 24th. That's when it'll premiere. And then the Beach Boys go on a... Wow, they go on a big tour from about the same time, that same day, the 25th of April in New Orleans at Jazz Fest, and they go all the way through to September 23rd, where they'll play the fabulous Ryman. I've never been to the Ryman in Nashville.
Really?
Maybe we should take a show trip and see the Beach Boys at the Ryman.
I don't want to see the Beach Boys there.
Who do you want to see?
I'd go see Leanne Morgan the next time she performs there.
I'd go see Wilco there.
I'd go see Wilco, sure.
Anyway, the Beach Boys or what's left of them are going on tour. I don't know who's in the band currently. I know that none of the Wilson brothers will be in the band. Mike Love may be fronting it along with some cousins and maybe John Stay. You just don't know what you're going to get.
They got any stops inland?
Oh, yeah. They got all kinds of stuff. I don't think they're coming to the Enormo Dome. It's mostly East Coast and Midwest. That's where they do their biggest business.
And where am I supposed to find a beach in the Midwest?
Yeah. Yeah. Actually, there's that new lagoon in Texas I kind of want to go to.
Huh? The new lagoon?
Yeah.
The blue lagoon?
Mm-hmm.
All right, it's time for Rock and Roll News Junior. You know, people ask me all the time, hey, Bob, what is Rock and Roll News Junior? And I say, hey, man, I dig the kids. You know what I'm saying? I mean, that came out. I appreciate the kids, you know. Out there. They're going to school. They're working hard. It's Wednesday. This is the toughest day of the school week. Don't you think? Wednesday? That's why it's called hump day. You got to get over that hump, and then you're on the downslide, kids, to the weekend. All right? And you might have been up all night with the storms and all that. You're going to be a little sleepy today in class. Try to stay awake. Do your work. Mind your parents and start a band. Start a punk band. I would love it. Send me your tape. I might get you a record deal. I got that kind of swing in the business. You know what I'm saying?
$2 off of a record at Target.
That's a good one, Matt. Anyway, the kids need rock headlines, too. And, you know, once again, I leak a story.
Yeah.
And a week later, it comes true. I mean, I got this rock reporting thing down.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying?
Not really, but I believe you.
I'm that good.
All right.
Who did I tell you last week was hinting at putting out a new album? The kids love this artist.
Billie Eilish.
Billie Eilish. The award-winning Billie Eilish and that cute little Phineas.
So sick.
He's so dreamy, isn't he?
Is he?
I think he is.
Okay.
So talented. And thanks to Bruce Springsteen in Nebraska, you know, Billie Eilish and Phineas got the inspiration to record their records in their bedroom.
Phineas makes
good. Do they still share a bedroom as adults?
Could be bunk beds.
I'm wondering. Inquiring minds want to know. Billie Eilish announces officially her new album called Hit Me Hard and Soft. Yeah! Arrives next month, May 17th.
You got it.
It is customary in the world of rock and roll and pop music to release two singles. This is the protocol.
Mm.
You announce your album.
Yeah.
Then two singles.
About 3 months out or 2 months out, and then you release a single 1 month and a single the next month, and then the third month you put your album out, and that's the way the industry works. A little inside baseball. The Rock's last great reporter. Billie Eilish says, not this time. She goes, this album is so banging. Phineas and I work so hard in our little bedroom and with our bunk beds in our shared bathroom. We work so hard on this album. We want it to wash over you all at once. When it comes out.
Gross.
We want you to hear the whole thing. We don't want to piece it out and part it out. And I believe her. I trust her.
Yeah.
I think she's one of the great artists that we have in our country. And I think Phineas, she's doing wonderful things for empowering.
Listen to Phineas' own work. It's good, too.
Is it good?
Without Billy, yeah.
Yeah, I haven't heard it. Is it instrumental or does he sing?
A lot of it's instrumental.
Anyway, the album arrives May 17th. Hit Me Hard and Soft. I don't know how many tracks. She's 22 now. She recently took home her second. She's 22. Had this. That's kind of Beatles territory there, where you're winning Emmys and Oscars in your early 20s.
Right.
That's. What were you doing at 22? How many Oscars?
Winning Emmys and Oscars,
How many
Bob?
Oscars did you have at 22?
Oscar De La Renta.
I don't even think I had my first Austin Chronicle Music Award at 22. I don't think I had.
Yeah. Oh, I'm sorry. Sorry.
I don't
sorry
think I had
lost.
My first Billboard Award at 22. I got them now, but I didn't have them then. I think I was nominated for a local Addy in 1986. But I don't remember for what. You know what an Addy is?
Mm-mm.
It's like an Emmy for ads.
Oh. It's slang for address now.
Is it?
Yeah.
All right, well, there's some information I don't really need. Thanks, Chuy.
You'll get to know what the kids are talking about.
Anyway, let's see. Oh, she's doing it again. She's going to put her record on 100% recyclable materials. Do not do that, Billy.
Don't do it, Billy.
Don't do it. Don't do it.
Mm-mm.
That's just going to be more pops and clicks. I'm going to just have to stream it and not buy it. And that's not what you need. You got to follow the. You got to follow the Taylor Swift model and release 22 color vinyl variants of your album. And then you'll really be making money.
That's the secret right there.
For you and that dreamy little fiend.
How you capitalize.
Phineas. All right, it's time for the Rock and Roll News Salute. Look at that. I'm right on time. This one goes out to Jack Kidwell.
Here it comes, kids.
Who sent me a story about the Sphere in Las Vegas, where I've been, to see you too. Fish is going to be the next band in there for a very short residency, and they're going to live stream those shows, either one of them or some of them, on the internet. So that'd be interesting. If you haven't been to the Sphere yet, maybe you can have at least a partial experience through Fish's live streams. So thank you for that story. Did we give him the wham bam? Thank
Here
you,
comes.
Man.
Wham
bam! Does my heart good. You can sing us out, Chuy.
All right.
To know that. My stringers are out there feeding me all the top stories, helping me out. It's hard to do this alone. Being Rock's last great reporter comes with great responsibility, you know what I'm saying? You know what I'm saying, Matt? Are you still awake?
Nah, I just checked out.
Chuy, you still awake?
Yeah.
Is there anybody alive out there? Hey, rock and roll saved my life. I know it can save yours. People say, hey, Bob, Rockin's dead. Uh-uh. No, it's not. We're just slowly releasing singles until the new album comes out. You know what I'm saying? We're just taking a little break. We'll be back. And I'll see you next time. I'll see you, in the skybox somewhere. I don't know.
The skybox in the sky.
You probably won't see me. I don't know. Bye!
My goodness, I wasn't ready for that at all.
Oh, man, we're back.
It happened in such a hurry,
too. I told you 60 seconds ago, I said we'd be back in a minute.
I know, I'm kind of zoned out. I did something. I'm a little, I got to, you know what I need? I think I'm finally approaching that age where you just got to take a painkiller every once in a while.
No, you know what? I got something better for you.
What's that?
Right here.
No. I meant like morphine. I was going to inject some morphine right into my eyeball.
I got some Next Evo Naturals for you right there. There's a free plug.
Made some good progress yesterday. Thank you guys for helping me as I started to feel the nerves of the oncoming, next 17 days or whatever.
What time's that show tonight? I got to go to the Cap City site. I want to make sure it's 8 o'clock show tonight. King Eddie Gosling, who you might remember. If you're a long-time listener, we've had so many great times, so many great trips, so many great comedy shows and pranks with Eddie Gosling, and I call him King Eddie because his poster is a picture of his mug with
a
crown on.
If it wasn't for Eddie and Charlie,
right? Charlie Shannon.
Yeah, would I have ever ended up on the show? Do you think?
I don't know. I think so. I think you know. I believe in destiny.
But didn't they? The two of them paved the way for Austin comedians to get involved with.
Even Eddie,
radio.
Eddie more than, because I think Eddie was a little more available to us. He's well, San
Charlie
Antonio
used to,
boy.
But Charlie used to. Oh no, Charlie used to write for another service. Never mind. Sorry. Yeah,
but we get Charlie once in a while, and T-Shawn, right? His
yeah.
brother. You know, Doug used to. Doug, who's going to be the head, middle. You know, when I hate to say middle. Let's say the feature act,
well,
which I hate
called.
That too.
Why?
Because I think you guys are all equals. This is like a triple.
That's not how the show works, though.
I know. But I'm saying as far.
But it tells me that you think less of me for opening.
No,
I
think more.
That.
I'd say
no,
I said no, equal. No, would I just say equal?
Yeah,
did everybody just hear me say equal?
I didn't.
I said equal.
I heard loser.
No. You're all top three names in comedy, and I think it's going to be a fun show. And I think Chuy and I are going to have a little dinner beforehand at the.
I'd do
Perry's, but
we can't
afford that.
You can hit Plank.
There's a new burger place in the Domain. Too.
No,
what's the new burger place?
Let's just
in the
walk over to True Foods and feel like we're eating healthy.
There's also Taverna.
No,
that's kind of far out. If you're going to be on that end, why not go to North? It's superior to Taverna. You should hit the Plank is what you should do.
What's that?
Walk the Plank.
The seafood joint right
seafood
there. Plank.
Provisions. Plank seafood.
I'm looking
provisions?
For the low cost option.
Oh, then you need to eat somewhere that's not the Domain.
Then you need to not pay for me.
Yeah.
Anyway, you talk while I look on the website. I just want to confirm that.
Okay.
8 o'clock show.
You do that, and I'll talk with Chuy. Hey, Chuy.
Yeah.
If he's buying, I think I'll join you guys. You guys want to go to Fleming's, get a
you
steak
pop
or something?
In. I'm gonna get something to go. Will they let me?
Aren't you getting your makeup on and getting dressed at that time?
Makeup.
Well, I don't know.
Getting dressed.
I don't know what a comedian does before a show.
Bong hits.
The calendar here. Let's see. Tonight. What is the date today?
Wednesday.
Four
something.
April.
10.
It's the 10th?
Is today the 10th?
No.
Yeah,
it is. Because tomorrow's the 11th.
Right. Eddie
That's
Gosling.
How that works out.
I hope I get paid Friday.
Unforgettable comic with numerous festival credits, comedy specials, late night appearances under his belt. Boy, they're really hyping that. That's pretty good. He was co-executive producer and head writer for Tosh.0 for 12 seasons,
correct.
Churning out over 300 episodes. Wow.
He and Tosh are super tight. They're good buds now.
They are good buds, I would imagine.
What time?
Show's going to be 8 p.m.
Okay. Well, at least now I know what time to be there, at least.
Are they still in Cali? Like, still in L.A.
Yeah.
and stuff?
Yeah, and Eddie has this great place with he and his wife and his kids on the beach. It's awesome.
It looks like
I haven't been. I've just seen pictures of it.
Do they not mess with Rogan at all or anything? Or there's no.
I don't think a lot of people. I mean, remember that's a huge industry.
I know. I always want to know
like
the
inside. It's not like there's seven people out in L.A. So you kind of find your comfort zone and hanging there.
I'm just trying to get some inside scoops.
Show is $20 tonight. There are a few limited $10 tickets. They may be a balcony. I'm not sure how they do limited, but there are some limited tickets if you're on a budget. But you got to get them before they're gone. And then special reserve tickets are $28. And Doug Mellard is on that show along with our own Matt Bearden being the ringmaster, the master of ceremonies. And that's going to be fun. I'm planning on coming out.
Me too. If I'm not too full after Bob and I's dinner, I might stop to the show.
Hey, there's a couch in the green room if you want to take a nap or something.
Oh, okay. I do like it. It's comfy in there. Next time we have a podcast there, I'm bringing my
Xbox. Are we going to have green room access to
Maybe that's what... No. Maybe what you should... maybe you guys should do is go and have dinner and then just take a... Just come into the club and sleep.
I'm getting some chicken tenders still too. I think.
You would at the club.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know why you're going to go. You and be amazed. He will go to dinner with you, and I guarantee you, he's going to order probably some chicken
fried
tenders,
pickles,
and something else fried.
Do I have to decide the sampler?
Oh, the sampler had it. Go all the way through.
Why do I have to decide?
Sampler does it for
can't
me.
Can't decide? Try our sampler pellet. Gee, I can't decide. I can't decide on anything. I guess I'll have the sampler bladder.
They need chips and salsa, but that's too crunchy. You can't have chips in a comedy crowd, huh?
They have chips.
They have nachos, right?
And salsa.
I think so.
Okay.
They got something. Oh, I don't think they have nachos anymore. Maybe they don't have chips.
They need to bring them back.
Anyway, we want to see the super fans out there.
Speaking of chips, is there any chance that you left a quart of whole milk yogurt in our refrigerator. Did you buy yogurt and bring it to our house?
No.
Do you look like a guy that eats yogurt?
That's the craziest question I've ever been asked.
We don't know where it came from. There is a quart of whole milk yogurt in our refrigerator, and my wife and I are both beside ourselves and stunned. We don't know where it just appeared.
Look, I don't want to stereotype, but y'all look like the family where a whole quart of yogurt might just show up.
I don't think a quart's enough.
Can I ask a question? What does that mean? I don't even know what that insult means.
I feel like y'all have yogurt. Like, y'all are healthy eaters. Yogurt's not going to show up at my house by
accident.
You
work out all the time. Yogurt
doesn't mean I eat yogurt. I eat protein. There might be some chicken.
Yeah, yogurt's high in protein. You get zero fat Greek yogurt. Get all that protein.
Bob, which of our households is more likely to have yogurt? A whole quart of yogurt in it.
I mean, maybe your daughter
found it.
Bought it.
She's holding it for a
friend. Think my daughter, who's lactose intolerant, brought home a quart of yogurt?
Oh, I thought it might be like lactate yogurt. Doesn't yogurt have probiotics in it?
Bro, I bought my first yogurt like a month ago. And it was the chocolate one, too.
How was that experience?
It was all right. It's just a little cup, like almost $2.50 for the little cup.
What kind did you buy?
Chobani.
Well, you don't have to go. You don't have to go reaching for the stars the first time you go for
it. Well, I'm not like you. I'm going to buy it by the quart.
A lot of sugar in there.
Just go Hill Country Fair, bro. They got yogurts.
Well, it was my first time. I didn't want to go. I wanted the good stuff. I wanted to be turned on by yogurt.
Right on.
Well, that's not going to happen.
I'm very curious as to who brought a big whole quart of yogurt. And y'all have parties all the time. Is that the kind of people y'all are bringing over?
I don't know. I mean, that's the thing. Yesterday, my wife said, what is this? And I go, I don't know, it's yogurt. She goes, I know, but why did you get this? And I go, I didn't get that. She goes, well, I didn't get it.
You're known for your butter chicken.
I make good Indian food for a white guy. I'm going to say that right now, and I'm going to stand up.
Does yogurt go in Indian food?
It does.
I mean, I don't know.
That's a good. You're like a regular Perry Mason right now.
I just monked you.
You got to say, hey, I rest my case.
The defense rests.
The defense rests.
On the couch in the green room.
Uh-huh. It is important. We're about to, at 8 o'clock, which is 1 minute from now, we need to get to what we call the Austin area headlines, the thick news.
Damn, boy. Lean in now for some.
Damn, boy.
Thick headlines.
I guess the big news, it's not news, you all live through it, but there was a heck of a lot of stormage yesterday.
Yeah.
Has anyone checked on Avery Tomato? Because I bet his pants are filthy, because you know how these weather guys love it. And you're going to make spots on the front side of your pants if you're a man and you're in the weather industry and you get weather like yesterday. It's what you live for.
Yeah.
You don't live for eclipses. You live for golf ball sized hail. Plenty of that. I saw so many videos of people's cars being destroyed and houses being destroyed. I guess my heads up that we'll give you from the show is always remember this. The creepy crawlies are going to come out of the woodwork over the next week.
Mm-hmm.
You're going to have people coming in here from, I don't know.
They're going to have drones sometimes.
Every district.
Roof.
And they're going to come by and they're going to knock on the door and say, we happen to be in your neighborhood. Would you like us to get up on your roof? Make sure you're dealing with somebody reputable. That's all I would say is I'd say, where are you located? Because of some of these fly-by-nights, they show up here. They get a lot of your deposits, stuff like that. They disappear. Look, no one's going to ask you for a deposit to get up on your roof. Just call your insurance. They can walk you through this. There's some great, and we've worked with them over the years, there's some great roofing companies locally. But make sure you're working locally because there are some nefarious types that show up. If you're a newer homeowner, you probably haven't dealt with this yet. People even going door-to-door now and saying, just give us your auto insurance information, and we'll do all the paperwork for you and get the hail worked out on your car. There's some legit businesses that do that, but they generally aren't going door-to-door, and then you don't see them again. You get what I'm saying, right? Just look at, be street smart. Be street smart. Did I do a good service right there?
You did a great service.
Thank you very much. Austin City Council has passed a new resolution. And this is doing the good work. They say they want to increase street trees. I'm hoping when I first read this, I was like, I love the idea of a tree in the middle of the street.
Yeah. No, not in the middle.
They're saying they want to increase something called green infrastructure. The resolution, sponsored by Mayor Pro Tem Leslie Poole, passed unanimously, and street trees can help mitigate the urban heat island effect. Could also reduce sometimes some of these weird weather effects that we get in the city that could be so dangerous. You get an area of a superstorm, and then when it passes over downtown and downtown's giving off that extra heat, it can really jack up some of the problems that we have.
All right, street trees.
Street trees.
Where are we putting them?
In the streets.
Okay.
I'm sick and tired of all these trees just living everywhere on the streets.
Not paying taxes.
Get a job, tree! Get a job!
Street trees, they're coming to Austin. We already have a lot of trees. I don't know where the extra street trees are going.
I don't know.
More trees are nice. I mean, it is a nice thing about our city. Sometimes you go to bigger cities and you see that they have bulldozed everything for just pavement.
Will there be coconut trees maybe? Or maybe like
lime trees and lemon trees.
I like that. Ooh. Like a Sprite. Call
banana.
It a Sprite.
What about a banana tree?
I'm not opposed to a banana tree. And fruit for the unhoused if they're around.
Is that a banana tree in my tailpipe? We're not falling for it.
We need to see if our friend Matt is on the case with the whole street trees.
Okay. Matt, let us know if you're on the whole case with the street trees.
Come on, Matt.
A little bit of pressing news, and I keep looking for updates on this to see if anything has happened. We have a missing person case in Austin, and police are asking for Austinites' help. Her name's Catherine Driscoll. She was last seen on East 18th and Trinity, which is just east of, what do you call that area? Congress? In the downtown area, kind
Travis
of...
Heights?
No. This is kind of by around the state capital and everything.
Oh, okay.
In between the capital and UT, what have you.
Yeah. I call that the DMZ.
Yesterday, around 2 p.m. is the last time that Catherine was seen. She's 79 years old, and police are asking for public assistance in locating her. She was wearing a purple backpack, dark pants, a light shirt. And, her family wants to see her at home. She's a slight, she's about 5 foot tall, 130 pound, older white lady. And if you see somebody you think maybe looks a little lost or confused and might match that description, let's make sure to bring some ease to her family. You can just call 911 right away, and they'll put you in touch with the right person. And her name's Catherine. Maybe she'll respond. Or she could be having one of those days where it's hard for her to respond, because sometimes things can get tough, and you need the community to help. How about that?
There you go.
How are those for words? Speaking of, Travis County is moving forward with their mental health diversion program. I love this. I think it's great. It's going to help keep some people out of jail. The goal is to divert people with mental illness accused of minor offenses from going to jail. Instead, they get some psychiatric help that they need. Sometimes you're having an acute episode, you know?
Mm-hmm.
I talked about this before. I had a neighbor who was... I thought was untoward with my wife, and then it really blew up into almost like a fight.
Yeah.
And then the more I was talking to him, I started settling down, and I realized, I think this guy is not me. I think he's watching a different movie than the rest of us right now. Mm-hmm. And then I started asking him some other questions, and it turned out he was someone who had served our country and having an off day. And the cops weren't called, and that kept him out of this jail system, which is not going to help. It doesn't help the jail system either. They've got enough to deal with. With actual criminals, right?
Right.
And this kind of stuff is really good. This is when people were talking about defunding the police. This was part of it, where they moved some funding and said, look, we also shouldn't be burdening our police department with having to deal with some of these issues. There are better ways around it. And frankly, the federal funding and state funding for any kind of mental health has completely disappeared. Disappeared. When people say stuff like, well, why do we see so many homeless people on the streets? Well, part of it is because there is zero help for anyone with any kind of mental health. That is on your family. And if you happen to be living in the city and you don't have family or family you can rely on, or if your family happens to be part of the reason that you had mental health issues in the first place, well, you have no place to turn, and eventually you can end up. These facilities would offer short-term treatment, less than 14 days, which really kind of helps somebody going through an acute situation. Let's get them to see a doctor, talk. Sometimes some people have just, frankly, you live on the streets, you don't have money available, and you, from time to time, you just stop taking your medication, and you can really have episodes. And there's no reason having these people in jail where either they can get hurt or they can harm somebody else. These are good things. I'm glad that we're spending a little bit of our tax dollars to make this happen. Going to make a better city for the rest of us. So phase one underway, and they're hoping to move on to phase two. Now, Chuy.
Liberals.
This is not a liberal.
Just give the police the tanks.
No, this is an issue that helps everybody. That's the thing, though. And I think one of the reasons I'm so impassioned about it is occasionally I listen to what some people sometimes call our sister station. And I hear phone calls and I hear people saying, well, it's ridiculous and I don't want my tax dollars going there. Well, where do your you want your tax dollars going?
Tanks.
Rocket
launchers.
Tanks. Do you want to pay
a force of Iron Men that are police if we
do
could?
Do you want to pay $150 a night?
When are we getting those robot dogs?
Do you want to pay $150 a night to get a person off the street for the evening? Or do you want to pay $1,500 a night in your tax dollars? Which would you rather do?
I'd rather pay for bootstraps for everybody they can pull themselves up from.
Even bootstraps cost money, my friend. We've got to stop thinking that everybody's trying to take advantage of us, and we have to stop deciding that our neighbors are our enemy. I know I sound like a hippy-dippy fool right there, but the thing is, it works out kind of nicely.
More happy pills.
I hope Greg Abbott gets you. I hope he gets you.
You know who's not happy about street trees? It's got to be Greg Abbott.
Hell no.
He ain't happy about the street trees.
Uh-uh.
And he's not going to be happy about this either. They've announced a date for this year's MexiCart Museum. Every year does a Taste of Mexico.
Oh, I want to go to this.
I know
y'all
do.
Need to be in here.
I know you do.
I'm going to come out, hit them up.
Is that Street Fest?
Why do you yell things like y'all need to be in here? Why wouldn't you, as a producer, have reached out already and say, hey, guys.
I'm reminding myself.
Our listenership is like 60% Latino.
I'm Mexican.
You're not even Mexican-American. You're Tejano. Your family's Tejano, right?
But in my blood.
What does that mean, in your blood?
There's blood from my grandfather who's Mexican.
He's Mexican? I thought you said he was Tejano.
One, I have two grandfathers.
Dude, he's done 20.
You don't even have a dad. What are you talking about?
He's done 22 and me.
I do want to do that, kind of.
He couldn't afford the 23
and me. He had to go 22. One short.
I have an extra.
He did 23 and me.
You couldn't do the whole deal.
Yeah, 23 and me is when he counted all of his uncles that spent the night at the house.
I'm hitting you up, Mexicarte.
23 and me is what he calls his family driving in one car to an event.
23 and me is the sleeve of Oreos in myself at night.
23 and me are the trips you take to the buffet. Your turn, Bob. Your turn, Bob.
Have
get him,
man. You got those were good.
Beyond a Culinary Delights, Taste of Mexico will feature food demos, music performances by Ballet Folklorico, and mariachis, screen printing, Loteria.
Hey.
It's going to be a blast.
There one year. That's a few years ago before the pandemic.
There's like 100 restaurants that'll be down there serving little tiny, you know, single bites or whatever. Yeah. And you might go single bites. You can put that together into a meal. I promise you. Tickets are now available. Early bird pricing ends this weekend. That's why I'm bringing it up.
Right, I got to get some this weekend, then.
Early bird specials, $65 for general admission, $80 for VIP.
Oh, that ain't nothing. You might as well go VIP.
But everything goes up after this weekend, so you might want to grab it and in a hurry. Hey, by the way, VIP gets you in like 30 minutes early. And here's where
that's what you want. You have to get all the food first.
That's the advantage as you get in there. If you're going to really get the bites, like some people are going because they want to see the Ballet Folklorico, right? Or they want to experience the culture. Boo!
Give me the tostada.
Give me the food. Give me the food. Can I speak to your... Hola, can I speak to... you can't do accents anymore, can you?
He can.
Hey, will you do it real quick? Because you can do it.
Can I speak to your program director?
You do a worse accent than I do, bro.
Y'all want Monterey or do you want...
I want Cheech and Chong.
That's not Monterey, bitch.
Give me some Cheech Marine.
He's California. He's not even Tex-Mex.
I tried to make it not as offensive. Please come support the culture and arts.
Hello. Please come.
Hey, bro.
Pip, pip.
Right? I heard something offensive on the radio.
Hey, fool.
It's no bueno, bro.
That was you on the radio? We need fake Manny to call in. He does the best accent.
Anyway, ladies and gentlemen, those are the Austin area headlines for today. Beep, 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 beep.
It felt really good today, didn't it? Didn't it feel good, guys?
Yeah, yeah, I forgot about that. I need to get that.
Mornings with Matt and Bob are powered by Chuy. And that's what I want you to know. I want you to know the name of the show. When friends ask at work and they say, what do you listen to? You go, Spotify? That's what we want you to tell people. Mornings with Matt and Bob. I'm still amazed at how many people don't know the name of our show. They just go, yeah, I know who you guys are.
I started this morning, you know, I came in. I just said to you guys, hey, I'm really happy to be here. I love working with you guys. Good to be among friends.
And you don't always get to say that at work.
You don't get to say that. And I forget that. And I don't forget it. It's just that you need to appreciate when you're in a situation like that at work. And it goes all the way up to L.A. and Johnny Rude and the people we have upstairs and some of the people in administration that we're going to see tomorrow night at the awards ceremony and all that. Mm-hmm. Right? Mm-hmm. Rosa That's and us. Nikki.
You know what that is?
What? Sarah.
That's my impression of Bob's lips on everyone else's booty.
Oh, I went clothes shopping yesterday, too.
Hey, get that big award right there, the big blocky heavy one that we won last year.
Will they just engrave the new year on this one, or will we get an
what?
New
read
one?
Read what it says. Radio on-air personality of the year.
Alliance for Women in Media.
Mm-hmm.
Austin affiliate.
Mm-hmm.
Radio on-air personalities of the year. 2023.
We have been nominated again for 2024. We find out tomorrow. There's never been a back-to-back winner on that thing. I don't think
never
it's
been
special.
A show like
sure
ours,
we
though.
Have ticket. Yeah, that's true.
What's that?
Never been a show like ours though.
Man. Well, that is true. But I'm just saying I really have. I have a zero expectation.
I have some expectation.
I'm kind of hoping for CJ. I'm kind of hoping for CJ to get it. He's never gotten it, and he's been working very hard.
We're here every day.
Yeah, 5 days a week.
We're here every day, five days a week, like we're contracted for. The only reason I have hope that maybe, I mean, if, and it's not going to crush me if we don't. I think we deserve it. I think, but it's independently judged by members of another city. In other words, the people that are judging us don't know that we won last year. Huh. So I would say that gives us a chance.
Well, why we
unless
even brought
they,
it up.
Unless they spread it around.
Well, I'm even bringing it up, is that we're in a very unique position in that the three of us get along swimmingly, and that does not always happen, first of all, in this industry. If you talk to most radio personalities, a company will hire you, and they hire you to be what's called first chair, second chair, third chair, producer. Like, they just hire you to fit it apart, and you don't even know if you're going to get along with the people that you're working with.
Right.
This is very unusual that we get to pick who we want to work with.
Right.
That's why it's probably the only company I would ever want to work for. But the, because we were talking about this morning that there's always somebody in the office that you hate, right?
Yeah.
Or you can't. Everybody out there can't get along with, or you just make sure like, oh God, I don't want to go into this.
You had a dude at work that you didn't like.
It was a long time ago. I can't name where it was, but there was a guy that I worked with, not directly, but had to encounter him every once in a while in the workplace. And he was kind of a racist and kind of a narcissist. No, don't lie. It's not.
Oh, I thought you were describing
here.
Matt.
No, it's not here. And it was just one of those guys, like, it didn't connect, and everything that he did was right, and everything that you did was wrong, and he had all the answers and all that. And I can remember sometimes at night thinking, I wish this guy would just disappear. Sure enough, he did. And I feel horrible about it.
What does that mean?
Like he just left?
Like I might have had, you know, I didn't have anything to do with it, but I wished it.
He quit? He just quit out of nowhere?
Yeah, he quit the planet, Chuy.
What does that mean?
You're saying he died?
Yes.
Well, okay, use those words. We don't know what that means.
Well, yeah. I'm trying sound to like not away. Sound like a bad person.
You wished a guy dead and it killed him.
You're a murderer.
You're a murderer, and you probably shouldn't even be out in the
years
public.
After.
This should be.
But he died prematurely.
Well, everyone dies years after wished them dead.
He died prematurely.
This should be like fifth degree murder.
And I felt terrible.
Why?
Well, just because I'd had those thoughts. I don't have those thoughts about people.
Some people are S-bags, dude, and it's okay to kind of wish bad on them.
No, it's not. My wife would say no, and she's a better person.
He deserves a chance of redemption.
Right, right. Which is why she's more successful than you and wealthier than you.
But
because she's a better person.
I could only listen. I could only look at so many white starch shirts and listen to so many racist jokes, you know, before it's just like, come on, man.
You've been to Texas?
No, I know.
And, this is Texas.
And sometimes when you're in
this
a
ain't home.
Sometimes when you're in a work situation, you get if you don't giggle at the boss's bad jokes, how long are you going to last?
These ain't woke jokes.
How long are you going to last?
I think you have to out racist them. I think because you have to step over the line that even they won't cross
to scare
and
them off.
Like, oh my god.
Maybe that's the way to do it.
I don't know. They don't want to hang out with you anymore.
I've been in some of those uncomfortable situations.
Well, we all have.
In a car.
Everybody
or
has,
on a plane.
Yeah.
And the head guy, the guy that hired you and all that stuff is just like, just unleashing, you know? And you're just like, ugh, I don't feel good about this.
Dude, I was on the road. Like,
None of the jokes were funny?
No.
None of them had to.
Not to me.
Come on.
I was
on the road with Jimmy Roulette. Jimmy Wingfield, right?
Uh-huh.
I was on the road with him.
Love Jimmy.
And Jimmy was on the stage. He was featuring for me. And I went back to sign paperwork so that we could get paid right away right after the show. And the club owner that hired us started saying the most horrific things.
What do you do in that case?
I didn't know what to do. I was younger and I didn't have any power in the industry. So I did what most pussies do in that situation. I went, and then I just took the check because I was like, well, I don't know. Am I going to not get paid? I didn't know what to do. So I just panicked and I froze. And then I just told Jimmy, I was like, hey, this dude's an idiot. And the other thing was nice is that Jimmy said, like, I was all kind of like, well, I don't know what we're going to do. And he's like, what do you mean we're going to do? He's like, you think this is the first time I've gotten paid by a racist club owner? He was like, dude,
yeah.
He's like, can you be any whiter to think that this is a rarity?
Well, we didn't bring this up necessarily to talk about racism. That's just one of the that's just one of the situations that you could encounter in a workplace that makes it not makes you not want to always be there.
Well, we were just saying this morning they don't hire you. When you go to apply, they look at your resume, and one of the things they never do is they never go, how well is this person going to get along with the other three personalities are there? And I wish that they would start putting that into businesses, because they just fill a team and expect you to work together, and you wouldn't have those friends outside of work. Most of the time, your work friends would not be people you naturally encountered. There's always like, there's the 23-year-old person and the 57-year-old person and then you in the middle, and the three of you were supposed to like hang out and get stuff done together.
I mean, even the animal shelter matches you, you know, takes some time to match you with the pet you're taking home. But what about the hygiene optional coworker? You could get into that situation. That's a situation you could get into.
I think the worst, I'll usually get along with everybody and we're all friends and laughing. But when I worked at Sirloin Stockade when I was like 16, 15. Yeah. There was just one guy that just, I don't know, he had it out for me. He would tell me like, oh, I would think I was washing dishes because I didn't make it to Baker yet.
Was he a little scary?
Or he was just a big, fat Mexican dude, but he was always just,
wait,
if I did something wrong.
Is this like Fight Club where you're the guy?
He was just always talking S, and then if I did something wrong, he would be like, are you... You know, like the R word, and then just constantly, and I'm just, like one time we almost got into a fight, but I think my older cousin worked there, and she did prep or something, and stopped us from fighting, and then there was another time I tried to buy ecstasy from him, and then I think they were placebos or some fake pills, and so, like, he was just an a-hole.
What about the guys that you could work with, and I've had guys sometimes where, like, they're on the, like, they seem a little dangerous.
Yeah.
Like they're just on the edge of something dark.
Yeah.
And you're not sure whether they want to befriend you.
Be his friend.
You mean salespeople.
I know what guy you're talking about, Bob. Be his friend.
Yeah. No, you don't want
to
be his enemy.
That man.
You don't want, but you don't want to be drawn into the inside of whatever he's into outside of work.
I don't want to be an accomplice either.
No, you don't want to be an accomplice. You don't want to be the wheelman.
But I want you to skip over me with the barrel.
But I don't want to make your list. What was that movie? Was it Billy Madison where, what's his name?
Steve Buscemi.
Steve Buscemi had a list.
Oh, yeah, no problem. Apology accepted.
And he crossed him off the list. And one of the great scenes in cinema, man.
Put lipstick on. I loved it. Let's go to Zach. Zach, you got any unruly coworkers?
Yeah, yeah. So I'm 38, shaved head, white. I did 10 years in prison total.
Thank you for
and,
your service.
So,
did you thank him for his service? What did you just say?
He said thank you for your service.
Yep.
Yeah. He made it sound like 10 years was prestigious.
Yeah. So I tend to like carry myself with a little bit of a serious demeanor. And white, shaved like head. And it always happens to where coworkers, white guys come up. And usually, I would like think you would like test the like waters to like see if you can joke like that.
Right.
But the in jokes come out, just all of it, and I gotta tell them, hey, you know, my ex-wife is black, raised a black kid, and it's always
get
funny
him.
To watch their buttholes pucker, and they're like, oh, well, no, I wasn't saying that, and it's just, yeah, but, I mean, you would at least test the, like, waters out first, you know, and maybe throw out something like minor, but they just go head on into it, because I'm white, I got a shaved head, and I'm like pissed off.
So well, cool. What you're saying, though, Zach, is you're like, you think they'd be smarter, but if they were smarter,
they
might not be racist, you know what I'm saying?
Like,
I think that the answer lies within the question.
Yeah.
I don't know. People like to say that it doesn't exist anymore. It's just real quiet. Yeah. It's just real quiet.
No, it's not. I'm going to be honest with you. It's not as quiet. It's gotten really loud in the last, like, 8 years. Yeah.
The dog whistles are loud, but the blatant, yeah.
Yeah. Also, man, prison, a lot of those guys, they got the swastikas and the AB tattoos, and they're all big racist, this, and that. Whenever the black guys come around, they'll start acting like hood, and it's just like it's just a flip flop.
Right?
Yeah, there's some of my really phony people out there, and I'm very, very fortunate in that 10 years that I did refuse to join a gang, refuse to join anything, which definitely made my time harder, but just made me like realize how phony everybody is. And your own race will throw you under the bus quicker than anybody. That's the lesson that I learned.
Well,
so it's always self-preservation.
I came out on the opposite end better.
Well, we're glad that you came out. Not for you. We just needed the ratings. So we don't really care about you or your benefit.
Yeah,
it's really
about
us.
American History X.
Yeah,
man.
Appreciate it, guys.
Thank you.
Thing.
All right.
Thanks, man. Appreciate it. Let's go to Christopher. Christopher. What's up, Chris? Warm it up, Chris.
You got a problem at work, Chris?
What's up, man?
You got any unruly coworkers or?
I was gonna say I was at an AutoZone one day, walking through, just minding my own business, and another gentleman walked up to me, and had kind of a devious smile, and he looks around for a second, looks at me, and he's like, "Man, it's like an episode of the Jeffersons in here."
God damn it, dude.
I was like, God damn.
I love that with the topic we were starting or we started talking about was about, I know, but it's very funny how that is the cut. It is weird when someone tries to recruit you into the clan.
Oh, God, almost,
and you're like,
that.
Dude, I don't, man. I'm just trying to live my different kind of life, bro.
I'm just looking for some seafoam.
I just ordered pancakes at the Cracker Barrel. Yeah. Why are you giving me this pamphlet?
And what did you say? Did you say, "Oh"?
I kind of looked at him and walked off. I was like, I don't know what the hell.
Yeah. I like that it's turned into what's your encounter with closeted racists?
I know that's not that wasn't the intention. We wanted to know about the guy that doesn't shower
better
in
it's
the
like,
cubicle next to you.
It does happen all the time, doesn't it?
I do have a coworker that's like that too. We were riding in the service truck one day, and out of nowhere, we were talking. I was just trying to make a conversation, get to know the guy, asking about favorite pizzas. And he brought up frozen pizzas, and I was like, "Okay, what do you mess with on a frozen pizza?" And he's like, "Well, you got to get there between the 1st and the 15th.
So you don't have to repeat.
Thank you.
You don't have to. You have to hang up on him. But did you hang up on him?
I didn't.
No,
but Bob dumped him. I think that's a good thing. I understand the point you're making.
We just can't repeat
can't
that.
Exploit
yeah.
it.
I got you. Sorry. Yeah.
It's okay.
Like, yeah, we're
it's
kind
okay.
of our own worst enemy here.
Yeah,
you know, I mean, I know you're recounting stories and you're disgusted with those things, but it just
I got you. Yeah,
we're just, all on the same page with that. We're all disgusted by it.
Are you okay, Bob?
But when you recount the stories,
it's almost like
salacious or whatever.
Look, yeah. when the same people that carry the same traditions and want the same stuff, they're going to carry the same stereotypes.
If you tell word for word the way that guy told the same joke, how am I not going to laugh? And then I get myself in trouble with my friends here. You know what I'm saying?
I'm going to laugh when you make a Mexican racist joke. It's not.
All right, thanks, Chris.
Bob's so upset with it because
race
makes you extra uncomfortable because you grew up on base and you kind of grew up.
Our next door neighbors were races and ages and
you kind of grew up differently,
cultures and
kind of zero race because that was
I never even knew I was. Well, I'm not really. I don't know. Like I don't know what I am in a way.
Boy, that's got to be about it. That's upsetting to your parents.
So how do you know when to be offended?
Because it was a kind of an equality.
I don't know. He just got offended just now. I'll tell you that. He got offended right now.
I just want to protect the license and the call letters because we're not those people. We certainly don't tell those.
Well, jokes. We got one of. If we get you tell, you use that first letter three times and you're right there.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway, we started talking about. We just got into this topic about how lucky we were the three of us. Landed together because you can sometimes be thrown together with people you don't get along with. Right. We started talking about this
everybody
morning.
Here's got good
and then
hygiene.
Bob mentioned
everybody's
earlier here. That he wished somebody dead and the guy died.
Yeah.
And we thought people would be calling in saying, and I guess accidentally at some point we mentioned that there's always some guy in the office that wants to tell you racist jokes and now everybody's calling with
It's Texas. All right. We'll, the calls will keep coming in if we allowed them.
No.
We get it. There's racists and they got some jokes.
Are you okay, Bob?
Yeah, no.
You look very uncomfortable.
No, I just don't hit the dump button very often. You know me. I'm surprised I found it.
Yeah, it's only
because you thought that's the button that used to repeat a segment again.
It just hit me wrong that he kept, giving examples, but we don't need examples. We can use our imagination, but it made me uncomfortable because we're not that show. There are shows in this country that still do that.
Yes,
humor,
and they are very successful.
They're very good.
They're richer
very
than us.
Very successful.
Yeah,
I was listening to one from St. Louis the other day, and I was like,
"How do you get away?"
This show sounded like it was from the late '80s.
Yeah.
Just the way they were talking about, like, they had a gay character on there. It was clearly someone doing a character who I think is somebody else in the room. And then they had a character on there who was like, yes, I had to come to work. And I was like, well, how are they?
How did he get away with it?
Yeah.
Yeah.
But it.
Not that we would try to get away with it. I was just saying, how do they
thrive? Does no one complain?
How do they survive?
But I was listening to it because somebody else was like, have you ever heard the something something show? And I was like, no. And they're like, dude, it is great. That's how it was brought up to me. Yeah. So I went to go hear it, and I thought, well, maybe there's something that we could do from there. And I listened to it, and I was like, this is not what we do.
Because nobody of substance.
Which is probably to our own detriment, maybe.
Here, this guy calling from Apple. That way you lose your job if you say something racist. What's up? What's up, caller? You there? Did I scare you off? Mm-hmm.
I think you did.
I'm sorry.
He's pissed because he's just like, well, dude.
Yeah, come on.
I was calling up with my favorite racist jokes.
I had a Puerto Rican, a Jewish man, and a whoever else walking to a bar.
Walking to an Apple store.
You're not there, buddy. I'm sorry. I'll put you on hold.
You scared him away?
We got to go to the other. Hey, Rick.
Hey, what's up, man? This is Big Rick.
Big Rick.
This happened when I was in another state, and the dude's dead, but it's not a racist thing. But this guy, he was one of those people, he's kind of like the two brothers and Always Sunny that wear the bathrobes and drink the milk, he's like... whenever he's around, it was just like he rubbed you wrong no matter what he did.
It's right.
Like you didn't want to be around the dude. And after he died, one of my buddies went over to help clean out the house, and it turned out the guy was like a pet hoarder, and his whole house was just full of pets and garbage. There was like paths through the garbage, and it also turned out that like him and his wife would like foster children and then use their serial numbers to make credit cards and all the stuff.
Oh, hell yeah.
Living off these, or not serial, their social security numbers.
I knew what you meant, but I love that you were like, their serial numbers. Like, wait.
Yeah. Well, same thing, you know. Yeah. But yeah, and they had like their plumbing was all jacked up, so they just had like poop in their bathroom just piled up on the toilet. So it was just like his car was disgusting too. But yeah, I mean, he used a different name from job to job and stuff too, because people worked at a different place with him, and he went by a different name, and nobody really knew why.
What?
After he died, all this crap came out, and it was pretty crazy, man. But good riddance to bad rubbish, I always say.
See, that's a whole other topic about how when you work with somebody for a while and you have a commonality because you work at the same place, you're making the same widgets, but then they have a party at their house or invite you to their house, and it's a whole different. You feel like right. How different you are. You're the same at work. Yeah. You're building the same widgets.
But you can also make incredible friends at work. And like I said, it's people you wouldn't have ever been thrown together with
in regular life.
Right. You know what I mean? You
have a different experience.
Oh, yeah.
And
yeah, I have many friends over the years. That, you know, I worked for a company for 28 years, and I, you know, in several different states. So I got friends all over the country with that company. So, you know, it's been pretty good. But yeah, he was really the only weird one that, that I ever just, not, you know, like I said, I'm glad he's dead. Good riddance.
Holy cow.
Thanks, Big Rick.
I don't know why I feel so guilty about this whole bit. It's all about wishing people dead and racism. And it's like, this is not what I intended on a family morning radio show.
Hey, it got the people moving. Caller.
Hey, good morning.
Morning.
So I think that this goes over the course of a lot of jobs that I've had. The kind of personality that I can't get along with is like the narc, you know? Or
yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, that one? Yeah, yeah.
Performance.
Yeah.
You know, like I feel like it's the boss. If the boss wants to find out
right.
he's doing a bad job, it's the boss's job to do the investigation.
It's the person, you know, that's trying to climb on your back to get higher in a company.
If it can go unnoticed and work is getting done, then it shouldn't be a problem.
Right. Yeah. That should be the boss's job if they want to.
You know what is frustrating though is when the boss doesn't see it and a dude is in your way. Do you know what I mean?
Right. Yeah. So I was gonna say I'm a little bit guilty of this. Years ago, I had to go up to Dallas, and this kind of new guy was riding with me, and he was just real weird, socially awkward. Like no one got along with him. He did a bad job, and he was like kind of mean. And the dude was acting weird the whole drive, and it's a long drive from Austin. And then there are all these red flags. Like he started talking about he was buying a gun, you know. And so I mean, driving back, I was like, dude, he's gonna come in and kill me next week or something,
right.
You know. So I told my boss, I was like, this guy's freaking me out, you know. So that is one story that I had. I don't remember all the details.
What's up, hypocrite? You narc?
Yeah, bro. You become what you hate.
I did narc on him, but not about doing a bad job, just about the gun thing. He was talking about buying a gun.
Oh, no one has ever shown up to their place of employment and shot everybody. Come on, dude.
Gotta save some lives.
That only happens once a week in this country.
Did you see the parents of that kid got arrested?
Yeah, I did. Well, of course.
Thanks, man.
They not only got arrested, they got tried, they got found guilty, and yesterday they both got sentenced.
I think that's the way it should be. That's how you protect guns. If your gun goes out there and commits a mass shooting, you go to prison. So you better keep it in the safe. You better keep it next to you. Keep it on, you know, your person, whatever. Is that extreme?
No. What if my girl goes out there and does something great?
Caller, what's up? I don't know what's this guy's problem, but...
Is it the same person?
Mm-hmm. I don't know. I wanted to go back to him, but I'll keep him on hold.
Hello? You need to update your phone to 15.2.7.
I think they're on mute, because that can happen. They might just be talking back to us.
Okay.
You aren't talking about me, are you?
Yeah, that's you.
Oh, God, I thought you all were talking about somebody else.
No, you're wild.
I don't talk to anybody.
You wild woman.
Okay. So I was thinking, I've been sitting here thinking about all the things you've been talking about. I have three scenarios. I have the alcoholic, the one who always has to have the last word.
Oh, yeah,
and
yeah.
Then the young one, right? So.
Oh, I liked it. You've been working long enough that you have the personality types worked
She's
out.
She's at the diverse company that will have all of these different people.
Yeah. So, first
Absolutely.
Of all, so who's the alcoholic? Describe that.
So, the alcoholic was a former boss of mine who would come in, and so I did party with him. I'm not going to lie. You know, we get together after work, but he just, man, would just go to town and then would come in to our office. We shared an office and would just snore, like that rippling, just snore. I'm like, dude, calm down. I need you to wake up because I can hear you in the other room.
Oh, so he would just be out all night and then he would come to work and then just go to sleep?
And then just go to sleep. And he would come in like at 9, 9:30. And just then he'd get going like about 10, you know. I'm like, you need some coffee, like what? And then I had to pick up the slack, of course, and cover for him. And everybody knew. That was the funniest part. Everybody knew.
And how long was he at that company with you?
He's still there, and
see,
I worked there.
This is what I can't figure out right now, and it's always kind of stunning to me because I'm so afraid always of losing a job.
It's seniority.
I was also just Ray. I know, but how do you get into those positions? I mean, we all know, we've all worked at companies where there's a dude who literally does nothing and continues to fail upward. And I'm like, how does that work?
We're number one, so thank me. All right?
Sometimes it works out to everyone's advantage.
For sure. And then you have the one that has to have the last word or to prove that they're the best in the room, right? And
yeah, the topper. I call them toppers.
Like, yeah. The toppers, yeah. And then I'm like, if you need to justify and show off your work, you don't have to do that. Your work should speak for itself.
What's an example of that?
So yesterday, as a matter of fact,
okay, because I figured this was about something specific. Here we go.
Excellent.
So yesterday I was given a presentation and I had a topper in the room. It was virtual and they kept coming up and talking about, it was a training and talking about other features that you can do that weren't part of the lesson. You know, and of course there's always going to be another feature. There's always something else that you can learn on a software. Mm-hmm. So at the very end, they're like, well, can I just share my screen and show you what I know? And I was like, there's 2 minutes left in the training. And you want to, and I was like, you know, we have another lab we can do that in. Right now we need to go ahead and wrap it up because people aren't going to want to sit here afterwards. Yeah. But it was like, yeah, you know, what, sharing your screen as if you were the instructor or you're the trainer. I'm like, oh, goodness.
Those are people that need control.
And I would never want to share my screen because I'm afraid I hit the wrong button and they're going to see something you're not supposed to see. And I'm fired instantly.
You're getting a virus.
That is very bold. And then your last was the young part. Now, you have problems with the youths?
What's their deal?
Well, the youth just made a really funny comment, right? So we're out and we're having a little social thing, a little happy hour or whatnot. And somehow we got on the topic of our parents' age, and my parents they would have been very old if they were still around, but we were talking about it, and somebody said, yeah, my parents are like in their 60s, and the comment she made is, can they still walk?
Can they still walk?
Okay, well, forgive their time perception is a little off. Yeah, they don't like
they don't know that 50 is the new 30, you know, or 60 is the new 40.
You'll be able to laugh at them when they have to retire at 80. So.
Right, exactly.
Dude, it's upsetting to me because I have entered the age officially, and I don't know exactly when it happened, but I will walk into like a department in this building where there are lots of young people, and it gets silent.
Quiet. Yeah.
Silent. Yeah. And it didn't always happen. It wasn't always that way. Sometimes I was invited, or sometimes some people would go, hey, Bearden, what do you think about this? We're talking about this. And when I walk in now, it gets silent.
Hey, guys, it's Cool Bob here. What are you talking about? What are we talking about here? Huh?
It is so obvious now that I have aged out whatever the young people's group is, and I am not even considered to be like the old friend of the young person group. I'm just the old guy.
I'm older. They still dap me up.
What do you guys say we go out and have some claws after we get off?
I smoke weed with them. That's why.
Maybe
that's what it is. Why don't you come join the circle? All right. Thank you, miss.
There you go.
Good work.
Yeah, you're welcome. Have a great day.
You too. Have a good work day.
Thanks.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Now that you just ratted out everybody you work with.
Oh, yeah. They're going to be mad at her. But she brought up the boss that likes to party with you. Yeah. I mean, I had one of those at a restaurant.
Was that weird?
No, it wasn't weird. It was just
male
like...
Male or female?
Male. So, you know, things got crazy.
Yeah.
Like, I mean, there was coke, weed all during the shift while you're at your table waiting for fajitas and we're doing like coke and smoking over here.
Oh, come on. I don't want to hear that.
And
what do you mean you want to hear that? That's literally called Austin hospitality.
But then something, like if something goes wrong and then your boss is there like whatever smoking or doing coke with you and it's like which one of us is going to be the boss at some point?
Right.
When is business going to take place?
Right.
That's the bad thing. Although we had a great bond, and I got out of a lot of stuff.
You had a great bong? Is that what
bond,
you said?
Bond. Bond. And I stole a few liquor bottles. And I was broke, so I would take, they had the prepackaged chicken and beef fajita.
You just take it home?
Pockets full when I walked out of there, Bobbo. We're eating fajitas tonight.
You don't understand. This is so upsetting for Bob to listen to.
Yeah, yeah.
This is, his body shakes when he hears stories like this.
I've never seen a waiter wear cargo pants.
I look, though, they were small portions. They were only 6 ounces, so I could care about four
ladies.
Or five.
Ladies.
So, you know.
Any under your hat?
No. And then sometimes it would just be blatant because, I mean, no one cared. The manager was...
No, you just carry a box out.
Yeah, even he was like, grab a tequila bottle for us later. I'll spill it.
God, that's so weird. But that's what I'm saying.
It wasn't weird. It was fun.
But I'm saying, how did people manage to... keep it together enough to get. I mean, what's going on that you get someone like that in your? I mean, because now you're doomed, right? Like that business was doomed.
Nah, I don't know.
Or is it still doing great?
Oh, they're doing great. Yeah, they got like three locations. I won't say who it is.
It's called Chili's.
Now Chili's has more than three locations.
I'm not saying who it is.
And Chili's is so corporate. It's different. There's still the sex going on.
And you know what I'd like to do, because I really did. I mean. I'd like to apologize to that company and maybe give them some free ads and shout-outs, but then I incriminate myself.
Yeah, it doesn't end up good.
Yeah. All right. Well, you're not the first...
That was 15 years ago,
you're not
though.
The first server who did coke in a walk-in, so but I wouldn't panic about
15
it.
15 years ago, statute of limitations, though?
Yeah, absolutely.
You can't charge me for anything, unless it's how much.
Well, they could probably charge you for all the liquor you stole.
You'd have to go back and then I'd give them the amount in airtime, right? Yeah. I don't know. I want to make up for my past, Bob. Don't think I'm just a scumbag.
I'm not thinking anything.
I see the look in your eye.
No, there's no look in my eye.
There is a look. There's no. You are a little judgy sometimes when we talk about real life in here, because yours.
I live
so
straight and narrow.
I know you've lived so prim and proper.
I would never take liquor from where I work.
You're cool, Bob, and you're very hip and cool, all those things. But some of the street smart stuff, though, about like what goes on, you seem shocked sometimes about real life.
Shout out to that manager if it's still around. Barry.
Yeah.
What's up?
This is kind of short and sweet, but the deal about the parents yesterday being found guilty should have never been a gun in that house. At all.
Probably not.
It sounds like they were not aware of what
they
were. Yeah. Yeah.
No, it was terrible. I mean, the kid, he should have been locked up a couple of years ago. I don't know, locked up is the word, but put somewhere else where he was than where he was, because he was definitely screwed up, obviously. Now we know that. Excuse me.
It's okay.
It's just unreal.
Yeah, like there's no checks and balances, I guess, if you're not, if everyone's crazy, like who's going to call on yourselves?
Barry, we appreciate the very informative and prescient phone call, but we're trying to talk about doing cocaine at work right now. So if you don't have one of those stories, we got a dispatch with you, my man.
You don't have any unruly coworkers at your job right now? No bad coworkers?
You don't have a guy you want to punch in the face at work? Come on, man.
Hang on one second. Okay, anyway.
Yeah? All right, we got it. I got to do Law Tigers.
You will in just a second. Right. Give us a track.
Y'all have a good one, guys.
Thanks, brother. Thanks.
I enjoyed all of that.
Will you throw in a track right here?
Sure.
I don't even care what it is. Nobody cares.
You don't care?
Oh, yes. Al, we care for that. That's what we want, for sure. Woo! Oh, my God, now I care.
This is all I heard when I was doing coke with the manager, Bob.
Yeah.
And trying to buy ecstasy from the other dishwasher. Van Halen would have done it. I'm not this way because I'm in Van Halen, Bob.
I'm in Van Halen because I'm this way.
Forward. Mornings with Matt and Bob presents Nods to the Odd.
Sorry, folks, we're a little late, but you're still going to get your wonderful Nod to the Odd. And there's some fun stuff in here today. We're going to talk about an older man in his 90s in Canada that might be in a wee little bit of trouble.
No.
Let's get to some of the simpler stories first, however. A man was approached by the police in Scotland. It had been reported that an armed man was on a train. So police showed up to the train station waiting for him to get to the next station. Does that make sense, what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So someone calls the police and they say,
Well, how do Scottish people talk? Oh, is a man on...
No.
Well, there's a man on my train. He's got
a... take a franca.
They called and they said, look, there's a dude packing heat on this train. And they said, well, where are you headed? And they said, here's where the train's headed. And they said, well, we'll be at the next stop. Because there's nothing else going on.
Right.
There's not really, like, any real crime in Scotland.
Not really.
Hey, someone's having sex with my sheep? Yeah. Get in line, buddy.
We'll get right on it.
I mean, there's a line literally in front of my sheep. Yeah, don't worry about it.
Put the sheep on the phone.
Everybody's drunk off scotch.
Mm-hmm.
It's no big deal. They're all watching Braveheart all day long. It's all they do in Scotland.
Freedom!
It's a good movie.
They showed up. The doors opened up on the train. They walked in. They found the guy almost immediately. There he was, standing there with his gun. He was a... also, he was dressed as a stormtrooper. That was another part of it. He was dressed as a stormtrooper. Turns out that another old lady on the train is not familiar with Star Wars and just thought that the guy was a sociopath who had dressed up in armor and was carrying a blaster and thought he was going to kill somebody in his armor.
She's not far off.
They asked him if he would go home and put his blaster in a bag, and they asked him if he would please not wear his armor on the train because it was upsetting people.
Like stormtrooper armor?
Yeah.
I'm glad we live in America.
I don't even know if that's armor. I think it's more of a polycarbonate or something that the stormtroopers wear. It's like a plastic, a kind of a bioceramic maybe.
What's so weird is how different trains can be in different parts of the world. I got on a train on St. Patrick's Day to ride out to the coast from Dublin out to one of these other small towns, and you go through some pretty, some tougher neighborhoods, we should say. And these two women talking on the train about the night before they'd had, and they kept producing little airplane bottles of liquor to drink out of their purses.
That's planning.
And then just hearing the amount of cursing, and they both had young kids with them, and they just kept screaming at their young kids. I'm just saying.
No, thank you.
Now, we didn't even call. I was afraid to call the police. I thought if the police show up, everyone's going to beat the crap out of me for being a puss. Like, this must be some life in Ireland. You just got to live with it, I guess.
Mm-hmm.
Not everything can be the fancy area that... where were we staying? What was that area called that was so nice?
Grafton Street, the Fitzwilliam Hotel.
We were staying somewhere all...
right off Grafton, right at the end of...
Fancy and fancy.
Right at the end of Grafton.
But then you
the
go through
end.
Some neighborhoods where there was just... effing this. I was like, ugh. Don't make eye contact. Don't make eye contact. They're going to kill me. I think the guy still should have been arrested for being a cosplayer.
No? Yeah, right.
Yeah, at least a fine of some sort.
I'm sorry to say that because I know we have some listeners who are cosplayers and nothing.
That's fine. And Sherwood's going on right now. How dare you?
Here's the thing I don't understand about Sherwood, okay? It is a festival that has just become anything goes out there. It doesn't matter. You can dress up in like a zoot suit with a Tommy gun and go out there. Like, it's just a fantasy fair now. What's going on?
Anything to get the nerd girls. That's what we're all out there for. Stop that right now.
Shame just saying.
On you. Does it go all year now?
What, the fair?
Yeah.
I don't know. Poor CJ went out there last weekend.
Oh, we saw the pictures.
Did you see the pictures?
Well, I just saw him in his suit of armor.
Was he rusted?
You should see the bruising and stuff on his body. Just because, you know, when you strap that stuff on, it rubs you wrong, and he doesn't have the right, I don't know what they used to have, some kind of cotton undercloths or something.
Yeah.
And he's all bruised up and cut up. He has armor rash all over his body.
You're not supposed to use the restroom in that thing.
He told a story on yesterday afternoon show where basically when he got home, and he knew, he was like, in the back of my mind the whole time, I knew that she was right from the beginning of the day when she was like, you don't need to wear all that. And I knew in the back of my mind, she's right. And they have to drive that whole hour and a half home silently. And they get home and she finally goes, you know, honey, you don't have to wear all that. And he was like, I know.
How else are people going to look at you?
How else are you supposed to be special in 3 acres of special people?
I mean, I just went there and got some meatballs from somewhere, and then nobody talked to me. But sometimes you got to put the giant armor on, and
it's the only way you can. You know, if you need people to know that you're special, you got to wear the special stuff so that the other special people know that you're one of the special people.
There's a guy there that dresses up like he's from an African tribe, and I really like him. Wanted to get a picture.
my wife got in a whole conversation with a guy, maybe it was last year or something, and he was part of some Klan da Oaken or something, and I mean, eventually she broke him down when he finally just went, when he went from his accent to, I live in Dallas.
I'm from Dallas.
Of Dallas. Me and my friends would come down here. She was like, yeah, that's all I was trying to ask is, you know what I mean? Just get you to talk to me like a person.
Why did she?
Why?
It's not a place for talk.
It's a place for giggling.
Mornings with Matt and Bob presents Nods to the Odd.
They're trying to replace God with trans people.
What does that mean?
It's something that a Fox News reporter claimed that there's a coordinated effort underway to replace God with trans people.
Well, isn't God kind of trans with the...
Wouldn't God be all
the Father,
things?
The Son, and the Holy Spirit? Doesn't he transition
and
through
isn't all Fox News Nod to the Odd? Didn't you just really just copy?
That's more offensive than
Fox
my God
News.
Joke.
Man.
Huh?
That's more offensive than my God joke.
What?
Out there.
What?
Let's see. What's her name? Lisa Booth is her name, and she went on to say she believed that there is a clear effort to remove God from our society and replace God with false gods. Mm. One of those gods being the trans community.
Are we voting for one of them? No.
They want us to bow at the altar of the trans community instead of bowing to God. I don't know if we're going to go that far.
That's what
I don't know if we're going that far.
That's what you want.
RuPaul for president.
She says there is warfare being waged against Christianity. And I noticed that, too. There's diminished. You can't even find a church in Texas anymore.
I haven't seen one.
I haven't seen one anywhere.
If you're not making Christianity the national religion, you're attacking it. That's kind of where we are.
All I know is that churches aren't doing themselves any favor, because I went to one a couple weeks ago. I try, like, we're gonna, my wife and I are always, every once in a while, we're just like, maybe we should go give it another shot. Can you inject a little bit of show business into it?
That's what I'm saying.
Please.
Like, if you can make it like
just a little bit of show business. I'm not asking
not
for
much.
A lot. Maybe just a sound system that doesn't sound like I'm in a cave.
You're saying that with all the competition, you're saying that there are 15-year-olds on TikTok doing better shows, and that they need that. Generally, a lot of churches are run by old guys, and old guys aren't always filled with the newest, hippest ideas. You're saying maybe not an organ.
Yeah, I don't need a guitar church necessarily, though a few guitars would be nice sometimes. But at least a little bit of show business or a little bit of legibility that I can understand what you're trying to say. How do you build a church, a modern church, and not have any sound... what do you call it?
That's your concern.
How do you not have any room conditioning or room?
Your concern right now is the hi-fi ability of your church.
No, let's start with that. Yeah.
Now I think you're asking for a little extra. Is that why you're there, though? Is that why you're supposed to be there?
Maybe some smoke and lights or something.
Are you supposed to be miserable?
Yeah, it's not supposed to be fun. At least that's what I've learned in Catholicism.
Do you think you're supposed to go to church at all, or are you supposed to do all this at home?
I don't know where it says in the Bible you're supposed to do a church, but I know that if you come together like three or more and pray, I think he hears you louder. I don't know.
Where did you hear that?
I thought that was in the Bible somewhere.
Anyway, I'm just saying a little more show business wouldn't hurt in 2024.
Bob, I think you're being a little judgmental.
I'm sorry.
And some churches are really good with the show business.
You need the right amount.
I saw one where they had a giant cardboard rock roll out of the way, and then you see that? And then Jesus ascended. There was a big giant cardboard Jesus that came out of the cave and ascended through the top of the church. And I was like, all right, this is actually pretty good.
I want my
preacher.
It was
a little hokey, but it was pretty awesome. Oh, did you see the one where the preacher gets?
I want him to come down like Sting, down on the zip line. Get WWE involved. They really know how to.
There was a funny video that came out the other day of a preacher who got into like kind of a homemade coffin. And the whole thing was supposed to be part of the sermon was that you're basically locking yourself in your own death.
Yeah.
But he gets in the coffin, and you saw it coming. When he tries to close the door to the coffin, it doesn't close quite right.
Is he too big?
No, he tries to move it. When he does, he loses his balance, and then the whole thing falls over.
Oh, no.
It's very uncomfortable, because it's one of those moments where nobody can really tell if that's what's supposed to happen, so no one's moving right away.
You don't know if you should laugh or not. Everything is technically the Lord's will.
Right.
So what do we do here?
What do we...
we're really caught up.
It is a dichotomy.
Yes.
Let's get
Mornings
into...
Mornings with Matt and Bob presents Nods to the Odd.
Let's get into this final story here. A Canadian man is in a little trouble. He's the 91-year-old CEO of a very, very successful business called ViaGuard. ViaGuard offers home medical tests. And as far back as 2013, they started offering DNA tests so you could find, biological fathers.
Oh.
This is some Maury Povich kind of stuff. You know what I mean? Because sometimes you're a lady, and maybe, sometimes what happened on Maury Povich, lady would say, I know who the father is, but I am going to test these 15 guys that I let run through me in a one-week period.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And then they would test all 15 guys, and then none of the 15 guys would be the father.
And then sometimes
that's not egg.
Oh.
That's not egg that's on her face. And sometimes she would come back with another 10 dudes, and then they would all test negative as well. And then she'd go, I definitely know who it is. And be like, really? Now that we eliminate 25 guys, you definitely know who it is? Then why not start with him?
I'd like to hang out with all the guys like that. I don't know.
I mean, I feel like that's probably a pretty good bonding party. You all got a free trip to Chicago or to New York, and then none of you is the father, so now you're hanging out, and you're like, I haven't seen you since we all ran that train. How you been?
And when you get, relieved where there's no kid you have to pay for, you start spending money.
Yeah.
Mm. I'm like, I just got out of it. Yeah.
I just got a huge raise.
I got a giant raise, man.
He's in a little trouble. CBC News was doing an investigation, and they sent a they do this to older guys, and I think it's not fair. They sent a cute undercover reporter to start talking to
that.
He admitted that his paternity, his prenatal paternity tests, these are the ones that you would do before the child is actually even born. He admitted during a conversation, a hidden camera conversation, that his prenatal paternity tests produced results that were, quote, never that accurate.
Hmm. Wow.
Yeah, that's kind of a... He said, we kind of knew along the way that a lot of the results weren't accurate. It was showing that a lot of people who were the father weren't the father. He said some people were getting very confused. The baby, the woman would test the white guy, and it would say no. So she would assume it was the black guy, but then the baby would come out white. But what are you going to do?
Hmm.
Bro. He'd be very mad if he said there's a lot involved if it gets screwed up. That's why we gotta be quiet about this. Here's the thing. If you're trying to be quiet about it, you may not want to rattle all this off, 91-year-old man, to the cute girl who showed up to ask you questions, right?
Mm-hmm.
You can imagine everything happens in life. You see them all and worse and worse and worse. Yeesh. Anyway, they came back and said, hey, we're actually CBC News, and we want to ask you some questions. And he said, I never said any of that stuff. And then the girl walks out, and she's like, hey, remember me? And he goes, bitch. You bitch. You son of a... Oh.
Well, you got to pat those reporters down a little bit before you...
Mm-hmm. Chuck them in a... Let's do this in a pool.
Make sure they're not wearing a wire, yeah. Exactly.
Atlanta man says his entire life, his trajectory was changed. He says, I hate the name ViaGuard. I hate the name ViaGuard. He was identified the wrong biological father, and it altered the trajectory of a 2020 pregnancy.
Hmm.
Yeah. Hmm.
ViaGuard just sounds like a dental dam or something.
There's a man that said he wanted nothing to do with this woman or her child, and he was pushed to through the courts. Anyway, this is tragic and disgusting.
I'm glad you brought it to us then.
Well, I got to do, you know, it's my job. You know, it's my job to do those things. It's my job to do those things. I'm forced to, Bob.
You take no pride in it.
I don't. It's just something I have to do because that's the, you know, the people want to know the Nod of the Odd stories.
I like it.
Mornings with Matt and Bob presents Nods to the Odd.
Hey, everybody, I'm sorry about that last story. I'm sorry. Settle down, everybody. Settle down, everybody. My God, you all need to act like that.
We've got torches.
You sure about that?
Oh, by the way, we still have a lot more show going on.
A lot more. More show to go. I like that saying. I'm going to put that on a t-shirt. We got more show to go.
Yes.
You driving us somewhere, baby?
No. I saw Big Al, Uncle Al, the kiddies pal here, and I thought we were addressing some things with him.
Well, I kind of put the kibosh on the music melee. I think I made a mistake. We made it too long.
Well, and let me just get down to the final four and
I noticed
knock it
that
out.
You checked out the other day.
You said this is terrible,
and this is really boring.
I never said that.
And
I hate all of you, and I hate everything. No one died.
And everyone sucks, is what you said.
No one died. I'm just saying, let's get to a winner. Let's pick. I think it's going to be Dirty Diana, anyway.
Well, I thought what we could do is just, we'll transition the whole damn thing.
Well, how many do we have left? How many matchups do we have left?
Okay, hey, I can look and see what we have left real quick.
I think it's still eight matchups.
I could end this today.
No, hang on.
I could get through eight today.
All right. One second.
That's right. You're not...
Bob, you can get through eight today.
Three.
But unless we remove our dear friend, Al, from the results.
Oh.
I'm not insulting you. You will... Can you say... Would you admit that sometimes you are more thorough in your decisions than others might be?
Yes.
Now, are you going to be this way when you pick a partner?
Perhaps. I think so.
Because we've been talking about doing a... We don't know if it's going to happen. We don't want to make any promises, okay? Right. But we've reached out to somebody who does speed dating in town. Right. We thought we might be able to do bring in some ladies that you could talk to. Because you mentioned, because when we asked what's something that you would... like, I think we meant, like, what would you like to learn about... You know, as far as how the radio station operates,
software,
or sales,
something like that. You know,
you said "dim bitches" is basically what you said that you wanted to get involved in.
Whoa, Tiger!
Yeah,
oh, wow.
You were, you're like, let me see what she's working with.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, wow.
Well, our friends at singleandthecity.com are trying to put together something for you here.
Yeah,
our friend Amber.
But that is a little, but I didn't even think about that. It's a bit of a concern because you are pretty thorough about making any choice about anything. You definitely go through. Now, this is, if somebody's out there who's looking to hire somebody, and they want somebody with an exacting commitment to detail.
I think you'd be a candidate for TSA.
It'd be a great hire for TSA.
Well, yeah, because he'd find... You know, he'd be the guy looking at the screen.
That's not what TSA wants. TSA, we just want somebody who's angry and yells at you. Take it out of your bag!
Oh, wow.
No water bottles.
Now, they got a lot of fun events, too. Single in the city.
They do?
Yeah.
What do they got?
Fitness singles, speed dating for singles 35 to 45.
Fitness signals? Yeah. Fitness in your single, you know what I'm saying?
Silent discos and speed dating, of course, later on in the year in May.
So, what else they got? Got anything else going on?
Boys' night, in-person speed dating for gay men, 25 and over. Let's see. Oh, lots of silent discos and lots of fun stuff for singles to go interact at. But what we're going to do is try to do a little speed dating here.
Do they got one of those well-hung things?
No, and I was looking for a tall thing, because he's 6'6".
Yeah, because, I mean, he's 6'6".
Him and Slim Thug.
He's 6'6" and wide-shouldered, and he's probably ladies.
You know what it is.
Like, in fact, Austin Fire Department recently called him and said, can we borrow the hose? We're trying to put out a fire on the 10th floor.
Oh, my goodness.
So I asked, you know, our friend Amber, and she asked, hey, can I know a little bit about him? Can you tell me? I said, Big Al, can you make me a profile? A dating profile, your interests, things that you like, things you're going to like about your woman, you know, your partner. And so I'd like us to go through the profile and maybe...
Yeah.
You know,
now, I know your mom lives here. Your dad works out of the city. But you say your dad's back in town for the weekend or whatever?
Yes.
For a hot second. Now, do they listen to this show?
Yeah, I send them stuff.
Now, your stuff.
Yeah, I send them the episodes and I tell them this is the timestamp where I appear.
Oh, wait, you don't think they want to listen to the, you know, they want to listen to the other times? What the hell's that all about?
Yeah. I'm kind of offended by that.
Yeah. What if it turns out that your parents love us more than they love you?
Oh, no.
Goodness.
A question for you.
Uh-huh.
Now, will you edit out the part where we talked about the big old hose?
They're okay. They understand.
Well, yeah, your mom changed you. She knows. She knows the dangers that you are.
Your dad would be proud.
When they listen, do they go, oh, we can't believe that you're, that show's horrendous and this is disgusting and you got to get yourself out of there. Is that their thought?
No, they understand. I'm joking around.
They got a sense of humor.
Yeah.
Plus, your dad's the one that probably passed on that big old hog, so he's probably just like, yeah, exactly.
Is
your dad, is any of them more strict or more, you know, conservative that we should be careful around in these
traditional conversations?
Now that your dad's in town?
I don't think so, no. Okay. Like, I don't know.
All right, he's not going to get mad at this, is he? Because I know he works for, like, you know, he knows some close quarters combat.
Yeah, he's on a boat right...
Well, that's right. Does he work... Is he...
Tugboat captain.
He's a secret CIA agent.
That guy's that. Yeah, even though he knows how to hit a wrench on the side of a dude's head, so we gotta be careful, don't we?
He's on a cruise, right? Well, not right now because he's in town. But like, that's where he usually works now. Is like he goes to Hawaii a lot.
Yeah, tugboating.
Yeah, he's on like a.
Is that what we call it when a woman is with you? That's tugging on a boat.
Tugboating.
Oh boy.
Oh boy. Oh boy!
Oh goodness!
Does he have a residency on the boat? Like, does he live on the boat?
Yeah. Well, you can't get on a tugboat and come home every day.
That's true.
It's a cruise ship, and I think like he works the security there along with other people.
Oh, okay. Oh, he's on a cruise ship right now.
Yeah.
Oh, that's good. There's a whole city.
You can't be on a cruise. Because it doesn't make any sense. You can't go on a cruise ship, and they're not gonna fly you home every night.
No.
So you guys going to do anything while he's in town? Y'all going to party? Going to take him out to Palazzo for a $5.99 prime rib or anything?
He's going to want seafood. It's Red Lobster.
Not going to want seafood. He's been living... All he's eaten is Red Lobster for the last however many months.
Yeah. What we've usually done is, like, hung out and, like, talk and stuff, and then like we've gone to like different restaurants and like seen movies and things like that and seen if there's anything interesting around in town while we're here. Like I think one other trip we went to like this illusion sort of museum and like optical illusions kind of thing.
Right.
You're walking through like different rooms and it like looks all weird and like take different photos that look all weird with like playing tricks on your eyes, something like that.
They actually just went to the mall, but your parents gave you acid before you went.
Everything looked a little curved and rubbery.
Okay.
Goodness. So I have Big Al's dating profile.
Oh, you do?
Bob wants to review and take a look at things.
Okay, Bob.
I feel like this is an invasion of privacy.
It's not an invasion of privacy. Then we're trying to help the man out.
Hey.
These are some solid pictures, I think. I mean, I would try to smile in some of them.
Yeah, I'm going to be honest with you.
Bald man with a stoic look is scary.
Yeah, I think
you got to smile.
You see that second photo? I don't think that works for you.
This says, is dinner ready?
Yeah.
That's what that says.
You got a great smile. Look at you. You smile almost all the time when you're in here. And the first two photos you have, do you feel that you're... Why did you choose these first two photos? First of all, let's find out where you were going.
These are some good angles. I think they look good.
You feel good. You feel like you look good in these photos.
They were the best ones on my phone that look like how I look currently.
Okay. Well, they do. Here's the thing I'm going to tell you. When a lady sees you on a dating profile, if the first photo is you in sunglasses looking serious, I think it's a no.
Yeah,
she wants to see your beautiful eyes. She wants to see your beauty. Ladies like your face.
In the seat with the seatbelt on, you look like a conservative commentator.
Oh,
recording one of those films.
Give me a sec. Actually, I'll do something real quick.
You're not being made fun.
You're not being made fun.
I'm trying to give you a helpful hand.
I know, but like
in that second one,
critiques.
I think that you're like, hey, I like this photo. This is the way I see myself. But it seems so serious, and you're not that. You're a much friendlier, nicer guy than that one.
You are. Now, some of the drip checks, I think, are great.
That shows a lady that you're ridiculous and fun.
You see that? He's wearing these. Is that, he has some character. He's not just some bland dude that, like, look at that. That second one's scary. Let's go down here. Alexander, Big Al, Ducko. There's nicknames.
Yeah.
Birdie.
Big Thicket.
Oh, I didn't know that Ducko was one of your nicknames.
That's why he wears the ducks all the time.
I know he wears ducks, but I never thought to call him Ducko. Can I call you Ducko?
Sure.
Sure, if you want.
All right, Bucko.
All right. Interest, pop culture stuff, movies, music, TV, games, etc.
We're off to a good start.
Fun stuff. Creative works. Editing, writing, drawing, performing. That's great. Fun and thoughtful discussion. Those are good interests. Hanging out with people, usually with something centered around this stuff.
The stuff above, yeah.
And food.
Yeah. Okay.
I think those are solid.
Those are great interests. Could I give you a note here?
Oh, yeah.
I don't know why I asked. I'm going to give it to you, no matter, even if you had said no. Mm-hmm. All that stuff is great stuff. You're saying, like, hey, I like to get out. I like to do stuff. I'm interesting. Mm-hmm. But I would write it in a more conversational way.
Yeah.
Because you're not applying to date someone,
right?
Oh, yeah,
you got bullet points.
You got bullet points there. Right. And a lady wants to know that you go, you say, hey, my life is surrounded. I'm constantly surrounded by pop culture stuff. I love comedy and I love comics and I love animation. Mm-hmm. And if you write something like you put in there that one of your favorite things to do is to write, but all you did was you listen.
Why aren't we seeing it?
Because guess what? Yeah. Ladies love a conversation.
They do.
Right? They want to go out. They want to share conversation. They want to share emotions.
They sure do, Matt.
And what could happen here is you could give the wrong impression to some young lady that what you really like to do is talk in bullet points.
And
there you go. Good response. Like it.
Yeah. Here's the other thing that ladies will like. If you say, I like to do outdoor stuff, not hunting or fishing. They love that. For some reason, they want to go paddle boarding. They want to do all this stuff that just doesn't make sense.
Yeah.
And you got to say you love that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Tell them that you carry a paddle board everywhere you go.
Canoe. I go canoeing. I go to the wine thing where you paint.
But there's also other great stuff in there. What lady's not going to love hearing that you lived in California, Texas, Colorado, Mississippi, South Korea, Germany, Okinawa,
Says you get along.
I would just find a way to make that conversational.
Yeah.
But that makes you sound much more interesting than I grew up and I've lived in the same house my whole life and I've never really seen much.
I like it. Worked briefly as a security guard. That makes you sound tough.
I'm a little worried that I'm reading CIA into this a little bit.
Really?
So I'm a little worried about that. Not you. You couldn't. Well, maybe you are an operative. Mm. Ooh, do you see that? He didn't deny it.
No. Well,
he just went,
Do you think he is in the CIA?
I think he could be an operative.
Do you think there's all this is? Do you think he works for another morning show and he's come over here to steal all of our great ideas?
Could be working for Johnson and Floorwax out of Biloxi.
Could be. Now, one of these other places.
At the end here, well, I don't know if we have to
talk about your YouTube channel, Galaxy Video.
Yeah, I don't know that I would lead with can't drive currently, but I want to at some point.
That's a panty dryer.
Yeah, it's a panty dryer, and they'll find out, and you can let them know later. You know what I mean? You don't have to open with that. They don't
just say I usually take public or Uber transportation because I'm forward-thinking, and I like to keep the world green.
I do like that you put in there, you put in your full disclosure. I'm on a spectrum. I have some ADD focus issues. But I love that when you say it, you follow it up with this other nice sentence. I worked on some of it, and I enjoy those who can help and even relate.
Yeah.
Because that says, like, hey, I got this thing, but I'm proud of it, and I like the people who will work with me and hang with me. Like, that's a great thing to put in there. I like the way you worded it.
I've debated, and I know we would definitely want to disclose, but, I mean, I don't even know if it's worth mentioning that, you know, you're slightly on the spectrum, because I think everybody kind of is. It is nice to disclose. I'm just hoping it doesn't, you know, women or whoever, potential partners, don't think something less of some sort.
I do like that you said some of my likes. Curvy women, if I may say.
And yes, you may.
But no exclusions.
Yeah.
Nerdy girls and tomboys. I would like to see a buffet of nerdy girls and tom girls for you.
And me.
Man, you go into some detail here.
Yeah. I don't smoke cigarettes.
Oh, do you you smoke a little PCP, though, on the side?
I don't know. I'm open if... I don't know.
Whatever gets me laid.
Oh, dear.
Drink socially, not religious or spiritual. That's good, but respectful. Politically left-leaning. You libturd.
Oh, dear.
Introverted. I think a lot of people are like that. Half the women I know are kind of introverted.
Yeah, dude. I think you have a lot of good stuff in here. I think my only note is I would write it into a small paragraph that makes it a little more personable.
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? That makes it sad. Yeah, put some friendliness into it because that's really all they want. They want to know the tone. They want to know the tone. You got a lot to offer, young lady, dude. You're going to be great.
Oh, yeah, that's a luck. I might throw my hat in the ring.
Oh, yeah. So the last bit that you left out, like right there, like I don't know, was that
some famous crushes?
Yeah, you can leave that out.
I think that is interesting because y'all can discuss that, like discussing opinionated things and then show. I mean,
yeah, I don't have a problem. It doesn't come off creepy.
I would ask a lady in the building what they think about if you should have your famous crushes in there.
Well, maybe that's what we should do.
Who's Sophia Gomez?
Should we do that tomorrow? Should we bring like Nikki down or somebody from upstairs to
not Nikki
go through this?
Not Nikki. We need to find somebody. I think we need to find somebody who is more of his contemporary because that's the thing is that Nikki's married. And no offense to married ladies, but do you know what I'm saying?
We got to ask
ladies who are out on the troll right now.
Do we have any upstairs?
We got to ask them here? If they're out there trolling, what are you looking for?
Okay. I'm married here, I think.
They got ladies in the building. We'll go around and ask some of the young ladies. Hey, would you come in and do a bit for us?
Oh, we have a lady that used to be our intern that works here. I can get her.
Yeah, exactly.
Perfect, because we need to get you a practice date. I don't see. Maybe we can even get you driving before the. You know,
we're
the
running
over.
A little long. We got to get into this. Yeah. So thank you. Thank you very much, Big Al. We'll continue working on this.
Oh, yeah. More show to go. Mornings with Matt and Bob, powered by Chuy. I guess it's a little bit of check yourself before you wreck yourself.
Oh, is it?
Because, you know, with all this eclipse stuff going on, and man, what a week. And who knew? I had no idea there was an entire music festival going on in the city that was sold out.
It was like what, Vampire Weekend and
some guys from Phoenix and everybody was at Waterloo Amphitheater. I mean, not Waterloo, it used to be Waterloo Park. Moody Amphitheater. I get all the Moodies mixed up. By the way, are we going to give away some WWE tickets?
Yeah, we got WWE tickets.
Pre-sale is today on that, you know.
We'll have a little competition, if y'all don't mind.
I'd like to go. It's been a few years since I've only been to one WWE.
I'm actually going to watch the WrestleMania on Peacock today because I heard it was the best WrestleMania.
Oh, nice.
In the past 40 years, so.
Well, anyway, there seems to be all this new interest about the moon now. And, you know, people are still making plans for us to go there. I mean, not the show, but as a people, and then eventually Mars. Are you guys, will you be down for that?
Once they set up the whole...
Big Al, are you down for living on Mars?
Maybe.
Well, what's the holdup? I mean, I know there's nothing there now.
Yeah, and there's no ships to get there, but what else is the holdup?
Let's say we all get it. Well,
they have to get the oxygen there, for one thing.
Oxygen is overrated, Big Al.
It really is.
It really is overrated.
I'll end up, like, in Total Recall.
No, they'll do that.
With three boobs?
Well, not that part.
Now, it doesn't seem that the moon is very inhabitable for long. I mean, we're going to put base stations there so that we can refuel there or whatever. I don't know. I don't even know. I got to get with Elon and figure out what the master plan is. But I heard him talking about it the other day. And I just wanted to get the ball rolling and see where we are. Are we down with some colonization of Mars?
That's the wrong
thing.
The
red planet.
That term right now is not a very good term.
What's
are y'all down with colonization?
Domination.
I dare you to wear a shirt like that.
I wouldn't use domination either. Maybe you could just say exploration.
Exploration.
That seems a lot better. That seems better than colonization.
Yeah, but exploring is different than actually living.
Gentrifying. How's that?
How about
let's gentrify Mars. I don't want to go until there's McDonald's.
Trust me, if we get to Mars, it will be a McDonald's and a Starbucks within 2 weeks.
Well, it'll be multiple Starbucks. We can't get away with just one. I'm down with it. I don't know if I'll see it in my lifetime. You know, even a moon base. We don't even have a moon base yet, do we?
Mm-mm.
No.
No.
But
moon pies, no moon base.
But we're set up for that. And the stuff you see, Elon's new. He's got these towers now that catch the rockets. They'll be able to use these rockets like multiple times a day now, because they catch them right out of the sky on these towers.
I thought I heard someone was starting construction to like some crazy elevator way up in the sky to like the stratosphere.
I see that in movies. What are those called? Jetsons lived in
space elevators.
Didn't the Jetsons live in a house that was on? Like a giant space tower. We don't know where it was anchored to, but it was just...
We were all going to be living in the clouds, you know?
How tall?
I don't know. Let me see who's developing it.
There's movies. I've seen science fiction movies where they have that, and I go, what's the purpose of that?
The Science Council of Japan is proposing a hybrid space elevator.
How far?
Dude.
Let's see.
You know some asshole's going to hit every button. It's going to take forever.
Some little to get to space nerd kid is going to get in there and just hit all the buttons.
Here we go. This is Bloomberg.
You got to stop at the stratosphere. Him. You got to stop at the ionosphere. You got to strap at the hemisphere.
You ain't down with Bloomberg?
Yeah, they're good. I trust them. They're a trusty news source.
I think they're real.
They're fair and balanced.
Let me wait for the ad.
I don't know. I just get excited about stuff like this. I want it to happen.
I don't know if it will.
This time, 500 years from now, they will put a breaking point right where we build the space elevator. This is pre-space, and this was post. This is an entire new society. Everything changes.
Now, is this that silo stuff that we read in science fiction books?
This is the same guy that comes to Austin every couple of years and says, I'm gonna build gondolas from South Austin into downtown. And you're there.
The concept is known as the space elevator.
What holds it up?
Significantly change how we leave planet Earth, but it could also completely transform humanity's relationship.
Hang on a second. Pause it.
Can't you let him finish? He's
pause
cooking.
It. Now, I know you don't think I'm a DIY guy like Matt, and I haven't got my hands dirty, but I've sunk a few fence posts in my day.
Okay.
All right. And cement and all that. How far into the earth do you have? If this elevator is a fence post,
you got to ask a scientist.
How far down do we have to?
You can't just ask a regular run of the mill construction worker.
No, you just get a weekend war. Does a little Home Depot. You got to want to set a little quickcrete in there and you'll be fine, bro.
Well, are you going to hire a task rabbit?
Hey, this is a whole city that's on and can go up and down on this elevator?
Well, you didn't finish the video. It's going to show you.
Okay. Scientists, you think we could have already built it.
Moonshot.
Space.
Is it going to go all the way to the moon? Are we going to connect to the moon?
I don't know.
It's a 1,250,000 miles.
Look at that. There's already plans from way back in the day.
Ideas of a space elevator type device extend as far back as the 19th century. But these ideas struggle to advance beyond the realms of science fiction as we continue to rely on tried and tested methods of getting into space.
Oh, you know, like rockets.
Like rockets.
Works.
I think Japan's
rockets.
But rockets
blow
up.
They use a lot of fuel. They take a lot of fuel to get up into space. Yeah, they have to carry fuel to lift the fuel to lift them into space. If you want to go to geosynchronous orbit, it's millions of dollars per pound if you want to go to the moon or Mars. It's expensive. With the space elevator, we reduce the cost of getting into space to
some magical
dollars
elevator
per pound.
I want a space escalator.
So how does the space elevator even work?
Yes, we've been asking that.
The basic idea is a cable would be pulled taut thanks to a counterweight.
Cables, bro.
It stays vertical because the counterweight is thrown outward by the Earth's rotation and the base is held down by gravity.
Yeah, you idiot. Wait, you couldn't figure that out on your own, Bob?
Wait a minute. Time out. So this isn't like a radio antenna.
No, this is like centripetal force kind of thing.
So they're going to put a spacecraft up in orbit, right?
Yeah.
That's going to stay in orbit, and that's what's going to suspend and keep this cable taut.
You ever put a bar of soap in a sock and swing it around so you can beat the crap out of your cellmate?
No, but I have done a spin before.
So when you're spinning that, right, and you got that weight out there, it's the same concept. So what we're going to do is we're going to put a bar of soap, which is a space station, way out there in space. When they get way out there, we'll go, throw us the rope. You know, now here's the problem. Here's the problem, and this is where it's going to get tricky. Whoever's driving the spaceship needs to make sure it's not his wife down on the planet that he's throwing the rope to. Because we've all seen what happens to boaters on the weekend when you toss and then you get into a fight you didn't mean to get into, but you've upset your wife because, frankly, you shouldn't have talked to her that way. She's trying to help you moor the boat. She just doesn't really quite understand because you didn't do a good job of explaining in the first place.
All right, so what's going up and down? These pods?
I think my problem is the problem with every elevator. When I hit the button, how long is it going to take you to get down
here?
It's going
to take a long time, dude. It's going to take a long time.
Did I hit the button?
A long time, bro.
Did we hit the button?
Also, it has to be pressurized, right? And oxygen, again, to your point, Alan, we're going to need oxygen.
Yeah. It gets even worse than that. But what happens when you get on an elevator sometime? Someone farts. Now you've got the way to space.
Space fart?
And that's you're just recirculating space fart the entire time.
They can't hear you scream, Bob.
Early ideas suggested building a cable from Earth up into space, but the materials needed to withstand such enormous weight don't exist.
No. Oh, really? They don't exist?
Hold on, Seattle's about to make it.
Is anyone even called Lowe's?
Breathe new life into the theory.
I've been working on the space elevator along with a number of other space systems and new technologies for the better part of 30-some years.
Sounds like you're not very good at this, dude.
To find a reason why we couldn't build a space elevator. There was no reason.
No reason, Bob.
The
problem with earlier versions of the space elevator was we just didn't have...
Wait, we built one before?
...to build the cable that was needed...
Blueprint.
...to maintain a space elevator.
If anybody can do a space elevator, it's this guy.
Looking into the future on where carbon nanotubes might go in terms of strength...
What kind of music are you playing in space elevator?
...of a super material. Despite
Girl
their
from
tiny
Ipanema?
Size, they're theoretically stronger than things like Kevlar or graphene. Brad Edwards suggested launching a rocket which would carry the carbon nanotube cable.
Okay.
One end of the cable would then be dropped back towards Earth.
What's so hard to understand?
The cable would be light enough and strong enough to build just a thin ribbon, which robots could climb to build more ribbon.
Ah, see?
Eventually
robots are building us, dude.
To carry heavy payloads.
Typical.
Such as solar
Typical.
Panels, satellites.
But why do we need to be
tourists?
Up there?
Bob,
what about didn't you just say you wanted to go to the moon?
Is this yeah, how many, didn't you just spend like $1,000 a ticket to go to the sphere?
Isn't...
I mean, my God, dude.
But what are we doing up there? What's better up there
you
than down
here? U2 is playing a concert up there. It's the same thing that happens everywhere when you build something new.
Bro, $82 billion.
That Bono thinks of every... That doesn't seem like a lot.
That's not that much money when you think about it. It costs us more than that to widen I-35. And that doesn't even have a single nano cable.
That'd be so scary.
No, we got to have our own. We got to have our own society up there. Laws. Is it?
You get on the elevator and everyone has to turn forward and then do that thing where you start talking. We barely. And you have to be kind of quiet. And it's going to probably take like an hour of just being silent on an elevator while you get up there.
Does what happens on the space elevator stay on the space elevator?
I'm going to be real embarrassed when we all get on and then we get the bing. It's too heavy. We can't go to space.
Are there elevator cops?
I'd hope that there's some sort of security. And who are we going to allow? Anybody can use the elevator? Or is it just going to be rich people again?
I don't know if you know this, but everything is always rich people again.
You better sell tickets if you want to pay that off.
I'm not going to make the same mistake that I made with the U2 Stadium. What's this thing over here called? Q2 Stadium. Where they offered me, and I was just like, I'm not paying that for season tickets. That's ridiculous. And then it turns out I could have bought the season tickets,
sold
a couple of games, and it pays for the season tickets. So essentially would have had free season tickets.
I hope this isn't like a what you call it, you know, the deep sea capsule guy?
Oh, where it implodes
it
on the way
implodes?
Up?
It just implodes? Like, I hope we got all the science and everything.
And are they going to be selling timeshares? Is it going to be a scam? Did you see that? Did you see that series?
Space and timeshares.
There's going to be Tina Blackwood commercials that are trying to get you up there. Yeah. And it's literally, they're going to turn it into Vegas so fast, dude.
So fast.
I will be so sad to see the first attorney billboard going up to the... you got hit by a meteor?
Even if your meteor wreck was weeks ago.
If you lived on the moon, you'd be there already.
Yeah.
Dude. Call law Martians today.
Yes.
That's call a good what?
Law Martians. 1-800-LAW-MARTIANS.
That is, yeah, I don't know. I don't know. I don't really have an, I don't think this is going to happen.
I want to see a movie. I hope somebody makes a movie about a space elevator.
If they can get the gondola like built in Austin that they try to sell us every 5 years, then maybe I'll believe that they're going to do. But I don't think that this is ever going to happen. I think that this is a pipe dream.
I think you just get a couple billionaires excited about it, and it happens.
They told us that in the future, all we would do is eat a pill every day. They told us by like the 90s, yeah, we wouldn't even have food anymore.
You seen Elon Musk? You think he just wants to eat a pill a day?
That dude definitely eats more than a pill a day. But they're all red, aren't they?
He's getting a little frumpy.
Hey, don't talk about Elon that way.
Not your Lord and Savior.
Let's just say he
not
designed
my truck comes
the Cybertruck to haul a load for a reason.
Are you so... Are you so mad that you love Tesla and that you have to work with two guys who just don't care about it?
Yeah.
And it annoys you, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Because he lives here and you know he's listening every morning. Your daddy.
Oh, wow. That is tough.
My car drove me all the way here today. All the way from my driveway to... It won't go. If for some reason it wants to take Fenlon to get.
It thinks must have saw some children there.
It thinks. Oh, all right.
You know what? Bye.
Oh, come on.
Bye. Finish the
we
show.
We got the show tonight.
Finish
we
got
to go
without
eat.
Me.
You're supposed to.
Bye. Bye.
We're
Al.
Going to True
hey,
Foods.
Al, I'm not mad at you. Okay. I didn't say anything, so.
I'm not in front of you. I'm not below you. I'm right here with you, okay?
All right. Bye.
All right. Oh. Your car going to drive you to daycare now?
I feel bad for everyone else because everything y'all care about I take as a joke, too.
How does Tesla Dan feel about this? I don't know.
He can't feel anymore.
He doesn't. Yeah, he don't have any feeling at his age, you don't. Especially, it's all numb from plowing through all the mail order stuff that he gets.
Well, thank you again for the money from the other day.
He forgot he even gave that away.
Yeah, all right, that's tech yourself before you wreck yourself. For today, for Wednesday, April 10th, 2024 edition. Trying to make it a benchmark. We'll see how it goes. Send your stories to us that you want to hear on Tech Yourself or Wreck Yourself.
Giveaways tomorrow.